C.O.W.S, context of white supremacy, you already noted a difference with the journals, saying Eric, his journal, he's got swastikas and Nazi symbolism and what have you. Dylan Klebold, he's got hearts for female classmates that he has a crush on or whatever the case may be. When I heard that, I thought, even this, I do not process this as what people, innocent, sweet, crush, teenage thing. I do not process it in that way at all for two reasons. One, Dylan Klebold also journals, I guess, apologetically. You can tell us how you phrase it, but he, Dylan Klebold journals about having a bondage fetish. Is that accurate, Dr. Langman?
Yeah, you know, he writes about several aspects of his sexuality that he found disturbing himself, including like a foot fetish, a reference to bondage. And he doesn't explain what that means. I don't think he engaged in that with anyone, but maybe in terms of the pornography he looked at. But he felt guilty about looking at pornography. So right there, you see a difference between Eric and Dylan. Eric never seemed to feel guilty about anything. Dylan was disturbed by some of his own behaviors or tendencies, bothered by them, felt guilty, tried to change his ways. So again, they're two very disturbed young men, but they were very disturbed in different ways.
Appreciate the nuance. The foot fetish, bondage, maybe he's looking at this on pornography or what have you, but we don't think he engaged in this with anyone, we don't think. The other component that made me resist thinking of this as some sweet, innocent crush, what have you, he and Eric Harris did some sort of school project on Jeffrey Dahmer. Is that correct?
Not that I recall. So maybe you saw something I forgot about. I don't know that they did a joint project on Jeffrey Dahmer.
Okay. Got my Jeffrey Dahmer footnote. So this one is in Why Kids Kill. And you write specifically, it's on page 203. Oh, and right in with Charles Manson. How about that? Dylan's favorite was Downward Spiral by Nine Inch Nails. He referred to it in his journal and doodled Downward Spiral repeatedly. See, those doodles are important. This album was recorded in the former home of Sharon Tate, where the first mass murder by Manson's followers took place. The album includes songs titled Piggy and March of the Pigs. Similarly, Dylan was a fan of Marilyn Manson, who not only took his stage name from Charles Manson, I did not know that, Dr. Langman, but also recorded songs in the former Tate home. Obviously, I didn't know that either. Bugliosi, Helter Skelter, page 67. Though there have been contradictory reports about whether or not Dylan was a Marilyn Manson fan, there is clear evidence that he was. A classmate stated that Eric and Dylan did a psychology project on Marilyn Manson and Jeffrey Dahmer. Angie Cannon, Betsy Streisand, and Dan McGraw. Why? Question mark. U.S. News and World Report, May 3rd, 1999. So yes, unless this is inaccurate, they did do a project on Jeffrey Dahmer, and I cited that there are many things that would stick out with Dylan Klebold that would make me suspect this guy is not going to have a healthy attachment with a female. Like, this could be some real... And he uses the term zombie in his journal. That's the same language that Jeffrey Dahmer used. Doesn't he use the term zombie to talk about us in his journal, Dr. Langman?
You know, I've never studied Jeffrey Dahmer. I'm sorry. So you are probably right, but I don't know that. But yes, Dylan referred to people with various terms, one of which was zombies, you know, looking down on people as if he were some superior being.
I I'm not a fan of true crime or even these school shootings, Dr. Langman. I just look at things, everything through the spectrum, the system of white supremacy, racism, and Jeffrey Dahmer was killing black people. That some people even submitted that that's why he was able to do this for so long. One, he was a white guy in Wisconsin, and then two, who cares about black people? Isaiah Scholes. And so he was able, and he even had a record. That's another, somebody with a criminal record, just like Eric and Dylan, even they are not on the radar? Nope. Stunning. And I knew that once I Bowling for Columbine, I had the mythology, Dr. Langman. Once I knew, oh, wow, these guys are in a serial killer, they had to be in a Jeffrey Dahmer. How could you not be? He was in the news every day during the 1990s. If they're talking about Charles Manson or any, how could you miss Jeffrey Dahmer? They talk about him every day right now. I mean, infamous. But yeah, let's see. Zombies.
For generalities, I generally say that if you want the ultimate expression of white supremacy and the white supremacist mentality, and you want to put it in the form of one person that I would name, and that's something I very seldom do, it would be Jeffrey Dahmer. He's the ultimate expression of white supremacy. Everything that he was doing, working in a chocolate factory, the whole nine yards, cannibalism and all of that, and calm, very methodical, Aryan looking.
Wasn't he with young boys too?
Yeah, he was. I mean, I forgot how many bodies is, something like 20 or something like that. Very methodical, very meticulous, went to work on time, excellent worker, working in a chocolate factory, looking at chocolate being churned all day. Been out there trying to churn chocolate at night.
Frozen femurs in the freezer. Jeffrey Dahmer.
The Katherine Massey Book Club, Context of White Supremacy. Gusty Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information for non-white people, victims of white supremacy, on what racism, white supremacy is, and how it works. Today's date, Thursday, September 21, 2023, so I have been told, remember that date. Debut study session, Lionel Dahmer's A Father's Story. Title of the book really tells you the main reason why we are reading this book. The book that we just completed, A Mother's Reckoning. We follow that with A Father's Story. This is a comparison, contrast, counter-racist literacy exercise. The whole goal is what we just read. Sue Klebold, Mother Superior, similarities, differences, how much overlap is there? You have a white parent writing about their mass murdering white offspring. There are lots and lots of similarities, but again, this is a comparison, contrast, counter-racist literary exercise. Take lots of notes. Pay close attention. I was very resistant to wanting to read this book for lots of reasons. I'm not really into all the gore and all the rest of it. And there was a different book that I wanted to read, so I just picked two in a row, I think. Next book is already in the hopper, waiting However, I was pulled back into reading this just because, hey, why have a book club if you're not going to do comparison contrasts and try to relate different types of content, right? What an opportunity that we have. And those Columbine cowards, they were big fans of J. Dahmer. So, I mean, of course, easy 1-2. Beyond all of that, Mama C pointed out, dang, that mega hit from Netflix that was released on September 21, 2022. I just found out Fox Nation released on Monday, as in 3 days ago, My Son Jeffrey, a four-part documentary that features, I guess, previously unreleased audio between Lionel Dahmer and his son Jeffrey. Watch it online. It's about 3.5 hours of footage. And all of this, once again, happening as the seasons change, transitioning to autumn. They call that the autumn equinox. I repointed this out from last year. This is also close to Halloween. All that bloodletting. I said that's white people's favorite holiday, so-called. The timing, 2 years in a row to have some sort of major Dahmer content for the equinox, that is no coincidence. Katherine Massey Book Club, A Father's Story, Comparison Contrast. Audio segment number one, Katherine Massey Book Club. Frozen femurs in the freezer, Jeffrey
Dahmer. A Father's Story by Lionel Dahmer, narrated by Scott R. Pollock. Copyright 1994 by Lionel Dahmer. This audiobook was produced in 2022 by Tower Audiobooks in cooperation with Echo Point Books and Media, LLC. It is my desire that something positive will result from all the sorrow inflicted upon so many people by Jeff's actions. It is in the spirit of this desire and in sincerest sympathy that I intend to donate a portion of the proceeds from this book to benefit victims' families. While no donation can atone for such tremendous loss, I hope that what little I am able to do will help in some way. Forward to the Echo Point Books edition. After its initial publication, great reviews, and burst of national publicity, A Father's Story reached a large audience, selling hundreds of thousands of copies. Inevitably, though, the media spotlight moved on to other news stories. The attention died down and the pace of book sales slowed. Eventually, the large publishers who published and distributed this work decided to let the book go out of print. Reader interest, however, never disappeared. In a classic example of what happens when demand exceeds supply, prices paid online for A Father's Story surged to hundreds of dollars for a single copy. Even used copies in poor condition rarely fell below $50. Based on this sustained interest, it seemed clear the book needed to be republished. In February of 2017, we signed a contract with Mr. Dahmer to reissue his memoir. Before publishing A Father's Story, Lionel indicated he wanted to make some small changes to the book to correct some subtle and not-so-subtle distortions that appeared in the previous edition. We readily agreed to work with him to publish the most accurate book possible. Soon after signing our contract, it became clear that it was going to take a while to make these changes. In fact, quite a while. Although we regularly checked in with Lionel about the edits he wished to make, month after month, year after year, there was little to show for our phone calls and email reminders. A big reason for the lack of progress was that Lionel was battling poor health. At this writing, he is 84, and his wife, whom he takes care of, is very ill. Even her aide got cancer. This made it difficult for him to focus on his memoir. But from my perspective, that was only part of the reason. As I worked with Lionel and developed his trust, it became clear to me that even though he and his household faced daunting health challenges, There were also strong emotional blocks to revisiting this work. Of course, nothing compares to the pain and anguish of Jeffrey Dahmer's victims and their families. But even if someone else is suffering from more agony than you, great pain is still great pain. Who could blame Lionel for hesitating before doing a deep dive into reviewing and articulating his thoughts about Jeffrey yet again? Who in his or her wildest nightmare would want to find themselves in this position? The pain and anguish over Jeffrey's actions would crush most spirits. Few of us could imagine what it would be like to have someone you love, your own flesh and blood, your baby and little boy, who you raised with all the hopes and dreams all parents have, turn into one of the most notorious and gruesome serial killers of all time. It took almost 4 years, but eventually we made the changes Lionel wanted. In the context of the whole book, these edits were small, but they give greater clarity about who Lionel is and thus a little better understanding of Jeffrey Dahmer and his actions. Although Lionel's memoir is just one aspect of a multi-layered and extreme tragedy, he does have a unique perspective for anyone interested in Jeffrey Dahmer's crimes, his upbringing, and how families deal with criminal behavior. What it is like to be the father of a son whose name is synonymous with depraved killing. What can his and Jeffrey's life tell us about the ongoing debates over nature versus nurture? These are hard questions to wrestle with, and it is brave of Lionel to share his life and experiences so openly. I can attest that it has been difficult for him to talk and write about his experiences, but his efforts have been worthwhile. I am confident you will find this book engaging and valuable reading. Marshall Glickman, Publisher, Echo Point Books and Media, February 2021. Part 1. If the police had told me that my son was dead, I would have thought differently about him. If they had told me that a strange man had lured him to a seedy apartment and a few minutes later drugged, strangled, then sexually assaulted and mutilated his dead body, in other words, if they had told me the same horrible things that they had to tell so many other fathers and mothers in July of 1991, then I would have done what they have done. I would have mourned my son and demanded that the man who'd killed him be profoundly punished. If not executed, then separated forever from the rest of us. After that, I would have tried to think of my son warmly. I would, I hope, have visited his grave from time to time, spoken of him with loss and affection, continued as much as possible to be the custodian of his memory. But I wasn't told what these other mothers and fathers were told, that their sons were dead at the hands of a murderer. Instead, I was told that my son was the one who had murdered their sons. And so my son was still alive. I couldn't bury him. I couldn't remember him fondly. He was not a figure of the past. He was still with me, as he still is. Initially, of course, I couldn't believe that it was really Jeff who had done the things the police had accused him of. How could anyone believe that his son could do such things? I had been in the actual places where they said he had done them. I had been in rooms and basements which, at other moments, according to the police, had been nothing less than a slaughterhouse. I had looked in my son's refrigerator and seen only a scattering of milk cartons and soda cans. I had leaned casually on the black table they claimed my son had used both as a dissecting table and a bizarre satanic altar. How was it possible that all of this had been hidden from me? Not only the horrible physical evidence of my son's crimes, but the dark nature of the man who had committed them. This child I had held in my arms 1,000 times, and whose face, when I glimpsed it in the newspapers, looked like mine. Predictably, as the evidence accumulated and became increasingly ghastly, I made myself believe that Jeff could not have done such things on his own, but that he had acted only as the tool of someone else, someone more evil than my son, someone who had taken advantage of Jeff's loneliness and isolation and had turned him into a terrible slave. I conjured visions of this other that were probably as satanic as the ones in Jeff's imagination. The other was an evil genius and manipulator, a diabolical Svengali who had lured my son into the circle of his power and then converted him into a mindless demon. As I allowed myself to imagine such a person, the air around me seemed to fill with darting, screeching bats, and I accepted, although briefly, a world that was as hideous and malevolent as the things my son had done. But I am an analytical thinker, and so, no matter how much I might have wanted to believe in the reality of this demonic other, I had to accept that it was no more than a phantom I had created to protect my son, to remove some part of the blame that had been heaped upon him. And so my first confrontation was with myself, with the fact that I am an analytical person. I deal in real things, not things that are imagined. Evidence is evidence, and it has to be recognized as such. There was no evidence that anyone had ever made Jeff kill anyone. There was no evidence that anyone had ever helped him do such things. There wasn't even any evidence that anyone had known what Jeff was doing. His neighbors had smelled disgusting odors coming from his apartment, but none of them had ever gone inside. They had watched as Jeff came and went from his apartment, always closing the door quickly so that no one could get a glimpse inside. But none of them had ever had the slightest suspicion of the horrors that lay behind that closed door. Jeff had done everything alone, everything in secret. No one was to blame for all these deaths but him, and there was no question but that I had to accept that fact. Jeff had done it all. He alone was to blame. So that was what the police really told me in July of 1991. Not that my son was dead, but that something inside of him was dead. That part which should have made him think about the misery he was causing, and so draw back from causing it. This part is alive in most people, at least to some degree. True, everyone is selfish at times. Everyone is vain and egocentric to some extent. But in most people, there is a line that this part commands us not to cross. It tells us that we can go only so far in the way we treat other people, only so far in the way we damage them. It may be that this part is no more than a chemical trace or a configuration of brain cells. We call it conscience, being human or having a heart. Religious people may think it comes from God. Sociologists may think it comes from moral training. I don't know. I can only repeat what the evidence clearly suggested, that in my son it had either died or had never been alive in the first place. In the beginning, that was my most profound admission, that there was something missing in Jeff, the part that should have cried out, "Stop." Chapter 1. My son Jeff was born in Milwaukee on May 21, 1960. It had not been an easy pregnancy. My wife had gotten pregnant very quickly, only 2 months after our marriage, and neither of us, I suppose, was really prepared for it. During the first part of her pregnancy, Joyce began to suffer from morning sickness, and as time went on, it steadily worsened into a more or less continual state of nausea, one so severe that she found it difficult to keep any food down at all. Her continual vomiting even affected her ability to work, and she finally found it necessary to quit her job as a teletype instructor. After that, Joyce remained at home, coping as best she could, not only with nausea, but with other ailments as well, both physical and emotional. As the weeks passed, Joyce became increasingly nervous. Everything seemed to bother her, but particularly the noise and cooking odors that came from the family below us in the small two-family apartment building in which we lived. She found the slightest noise unbearable, and every odor, regardless of how ordinary, was insufferable to her. She continually demanded that I do something about these things. She wanted me to complain about every noise, every odor, but this was something that I simply could not do. I have always found it difficult to confront other people, and certainly I felt unable to confront my downstairs neighbors about noises and odors that were well within normal range. The fact is, none of the problems that Joyce continually complained about seemed very bad to me. But they seemed very bad to Joyce, and over time she grew increasingly irritable at my refusal to complain to our neighbors. Because of that, we began to argue. At times, the arguments were very heated, and once, to escape the tension they generated, Joyce left the house completely and walked to a nearby park, where she sat on a bench, wrapped in her coat, all alone in the snow, until I came for her, tugged her from the bench, and walked her back to the house. I can remember how she trembled beneath my arm as I led her home. There was a real sadness in her face, but there didn't seem to be much I could do to relieve it. I felt helpless. She would ask me if I loved her, and I would always reassure her, even though these reassurances never seemed to satisfy her. When I think of those moments now, I think of my wife's need for love and my inability to show it in a way that would have been meaningful to her. I showed love by working, by striving, by tending to her every physical need, by moving toward a future which I expected to share with her. That was not what she needed, of course, but it was all that I could give. Thinking analytically, which is the way I tend to think, I saw myself as a dutiful husband, a provider of the essentials, food, clothing, shelter, the kind of man my father had been, which served as my only model for what a husband should be. The fact that Joyce found it difficult to accept me as I was continued to plague our marriage in the coming months. It was a problem which our living conditions only made worse, and in the end, it became clear that these conditions, at least, had to be changed. The smell of our neighbors' cooking struck Joyce as rancid, the rustling of their pots and pans intolerably disruptive. Both kept her from sleep, and so afflicted her nerves that she began to develop uncontrollable muscle spasms, which distressed her even more. And so, approximately 2 months before Jeff's birth, in March of 1960, we moved to my parents' house in West Allis, Wisconsin. But this move did very little to relieve Joyce's condition. She continued to suffer from long bouts of nausea, but now a form of rigidity developed, one which none of the doctors who saw her was ever able to diagnose exactly. At times, her legs would lock tightly in place, and her whole body would grow rigid and begin to tremble. Her jaw would jerk to the right and take on a similarly frightening rigidity. During these strange seizures, her eyes would bulge like a frightened animal, and she would begin to salivate, literally frothing at the mouth. Each time Joyce was taken by one of these seizures, I would take turns with my parents walking her around the dining room in an attempt to relieve the rigidity. Slowly, we would make our way around the dining room table, Joyce barely able to walk but doing her best while I held her up. This procedure very rarely worked, however. Because of that, a doctor would usually have to intervene, giving Joyce injections of barbiturates and morphine, which would finally relax her. Joyce's doctor could find no medical reason for these sudden attacks. He suggested that they were rooted in Joyce's mental rather than her physical state. He said that they were probably tied to her being pregnant with her first baby. Still, something had to be done, and so he added phenobarbital to the list of medications that had already been prescribed. This additional medication appeared to do little good, however, and Joyce's emotional condition worsened. She became increasingly tense and irritable. She took offense quickly and often seemed angry both with others and at the generally harsh nature of her pregnancy. During this period, I did what I thought I could do to keep Joyce comfortable, but at the same time, I realize now, I also left her alone with my parents quite often. I was a graduate student at Marquette University, studying for my master's in analytical chemistry. I was also working as a graduate assistant. As a result, I was away from home for much of the day, particularly during the last 2 months of her pregnancy. I would leave her at 7 in the morning and often not return until 7 or 8 in the evening. During those long intervening hours, Joyce was forced to remain more or less housebound with my mother. She did not even have a driver's license. There was no relief, and if Joyce sometimes reacted with anger and resentment, it was not a reaction that anyone should find surprising. Despite all that, I was often baffled by what I saw as her inability to cope. The noise and odors that had driven her from our first apartment never seemed more than ordinary, and the situation at my parents' house appeared tolerable. Why was she so upset all the time? What was it that she found so dreadful? As I learned later, it would have been impossible for me to have understood Joyce's situation. Her emotional makeup was totally different from mine. It was marked by peaks and valleys, highs and lows. Mine, as I have since discovered, was then, and still remains, a broad, flat plain. To deal with the dips in her physical and emotional condition, Joyce continued taking various drugs. She would sometimes take as many as 26 pills a day. No doubt these helped to relieve some of her physical suffering, but for her emotional distress, the sense of helplessness and isolation that sometimes overwhelmed her, there appeared to be no relief. The irritability continued, and she grew more and more alienated from both me and my parents. I felt helpless to do anything about it. I found it difficult, as I have always found it difficult, to read the exact emotional state of another person, and during this time I certainly found it difficult to read Joyce. So I floundered about, doing what I could, for the most part, ineffectively. Joyce often lashed out at these awkward attempts to comfort her, a reaction that sometimes baffled me, since such anger was so different from my own way of handling things, the general passivity with which I have more often reacted to the ups and downs of life. In any event, we never really came to terms with the conflicts of that first year. Because of that, I think that this first troubled experience laid the foundation for a longer and even more troubled marriage. In some sense, our relationship never recovered from the damage done to it at this early stage, never really improved. Then, at the end of this long trial, my son was born. I was at Marquette when he came. It was around 4:45 in the afternoon, and I was working in the graduate assistant office when the phone rang. It was my mother, telling me that my father had already taken Joyce to Deaconess Hospital, only a few blocks from Marquette. I drove to the hospital immediately and discovered that Jeff had already been delivered. I went directly to Joyce's room and found her in bed, looking exhausted, of course, but also quite happy for the first time in many weeks. "You have a son," she said. A few minutes later, I saw my son for the first time. He was in a small plastic bassinet, his body wrapped in a blue blanket. I could see him lying motionlessly on his side, eyes closed, sleeping quietly. I stared at him, astonished at how much he looked like me, how much I saw my own features, as if in miniature, in that tiny pinkish face. Joyce had said, "You have a son." And so I did. A son I would later name for myself, Jeffrey Lionel Dahmer. Jeffrey came home a few days later. One of his small legs was in a cast, a necessary orthopedic correction for a minor deformity, but otherwise he was perfectly fine. Joyce held him gently in her arms, and as I drove all of us home, I could see his small eyes peering here and there, taking in the world for the first time. I often think of him in that initial innocence. I imagine the shapes he must have seen, the blur of moving colors, and as I recall him in his infancy, I feel overwhelmed by a sense of helpless dread. I consider his eyes blinking softly, and then I remember all the horrors they will later see. I dwell on the small pink hands, and in my mind I watch them grow larger and darker as I think about all that they will later do, of how stained they will become with the blood of others. It is impossible to reconcile these visions or to escape their sadness. They are like scenes from separate worlds, pages from different books, so that it is impossible to imagine how the end of my son's life could have sprung from the beginning of it. For during those first few days after we brought Jeff home, a happiness settled over us. The long ordeal of Joyce's pregnancy seemed over, a dreadful hardship which Jeff's birth had all but obliterated from our memories. For a time, we experienced that kind of joy which only parents know, the sense of life's being suddenly renewed and intensified. It was a happiness and lightheartedness that Joyce seemed to capture in the birth announcement she wrote and drew herself and sent to friends and relatives. On the front, she sketched a picture of a happy, smiling baby, surrounded by a swirl of pink bubbles, its tiny fist wrapped around a slide rule. Inside, Joyce had written a short poem. Chemistry has many phases, with chemists in a fuss. Well, here's our little formula, patented by us. But it was a happiness that lasted for only the shortest time. Within a few days of bringing Jeff home, problems began to develop once again. First of all, there was the question of nursing. Something in the process seriously disturbed Joyce and made her irritable. She began to dread it terribly. My mother encouraged her to relax. She told Joyce that the initial pain and nervousness were natural, and that she would settle into the nursing routine after a short time. But Joyce never settled into nursing, never accepted it, and within a few days she gave it up altogether. Her breasts were bound with a sheet in order to dry them up, and Jeff was henceforth fed by bottle. As the days passed, other problems emerged. The cramped space of the bedroom we shared with Jeff was a source of strain and discontent. There were arguments with my mother, and after a while, these arguments settled into a permanent state of tension and bad feeling. Increasingly, Joyce withdrew from my mother, refusing to come down to the table to join the rest of us for dinner. Instead, she remained upstairs, alone in her bed, with Jeff sleeping quietly in the small bassinet a few feet away. There were also arguments with me, disputes that seemed to have no solution. Often, Joyce would leave the house, and once, I found her nearly 5 blocks away, lying in a field of high grass, her body draped only in her nightgown. By then, of course, I had become aware of Joyce's own childhood, of her father's alcoholism, of the long battle she had waged to overcome the domination and wildly explosive behavior he had imposed upon her and her entire family. But when I tried to analyze her situation, I always reached a wall I couldn't climb. What could I possibly do about her past? How could I make up for it? What could Joyce do about it other than finally put it behind her? In my view, the point was to forget whatever fear or cruelty she had experienced as a child and to concentrate on the future. It seemed simple to me, clear and uncomplicated. You either overcame difficulties or you were crushed by them. My view, of course, was utterly one-dimensional. To that degree, it was also unreal, since it failed to recognize that Joyce was more complicated and certainly more deeply wounded than I could imagine. She baffled me, and I felt helpless in dealing with her. I couldn't understand where her fears and rages came from, and so I often avoided her, fleeing to my laboratory, where things were considerably less volatile and where all reactions could be systematically controlled. Because of that, Joyce often remained alone for long periods of time, isolated, in some sense helpless, while I was at work at Marquette, my life taking on a predictable and immensely comforting routine. I had tried to adjust my work schedule, of course, but all the same, and even when at home, I often occupied myself with coursework and studying for exams. I was at home physically, but some other part of me was busy with other matters, with the future, as I saw it, the career which would, in the end, come to support my wife and child. After a time, it became impossible to remain in my parents' house. There was just too much tension. And so, toward the beginning of September, when Jeff was 4 months old, we moved to Van Buren Street on the east side of Milwaukee. The new residence was an old house that had been divided into 6 separate apartments. It wasn't exactly run down, but it wasn't exactly modern either. We had a 1-bedroom apartment in the house, and it looked down on a working-class district of the city, a place for families, with small, inexpensive restaurants and ice cream parlors, the sort of place in which a struggling graduate student could locate his wife and child with a reasonable sense that they would be safe while he was away. By this time, Jeff was babbling happily. He took great delight in sitting in his high chair while we fed him, energetically spitting his food out even as we struggled to make him eat. He seemed to take a fierce joy in this practice, laughing all the way down to the bottom of his stomach, his whole body shaking as if seized in a frenzy of enjoyment. For the next 2 years, we continued to live in this apartment while I worked at Marquette. Joyce remained at home with Jeff, seeing to his every need. She would take him for walks in the buggy, once as far as 5 miles to Marquette University to surprise me. During all this time, our relationship was a mixture of good and bad times. It was not the period of constant tension it would later become. Joyce became more relaxed, as if she were beginning to adapt to her new role of wife and mother. To me, she seemed reasonably happy, reasonably content. As for Jeff, he remained a bubbly, likable child. He played continually in his spider walker, scooting in all directions through the house and on the sidewalk on the side of the house, once hitting a crack, toppling over, bloodying his chin. I swept him into the house where Joyce applied first aid, and we comforted him as he gradually stopped shaking and sucking in his breath in fright. He played with the usual stuffed toys, bunnies and dogs, with wooden blocks that he loved to stack carefully and then push over with a sudden powerful thrust. In the fall, while in his playpen, he would sometimes gather up the surrounding leaves and begin to tear at them fiercely. Once, when I asked him what he was doing, he replied simply, "Reputa leaves," which meant ripping the leaves. Then he smiled. In September of 1962, I was offered a graduate assistantship in the Ph.D. program at Iowa State University. I took it, and shortly after that, Joyce, Jeff, and I moved to the university's campus at Ames, Iowa. We set up housekeeping in a small wooden house owned by the university and located at a place called Pamel Court. It was quite a bit smaller than our old apartment in Milwaukee, and it was surrounded by similar structures, along with an assortment of Quonset huts that had been constructed during the Second World War. The university offer had included a generous stipend, and both Joyce and I saw the move as a step up, a move we were both making toward a better future. Once in the new house, I quickly got into my new work at the university. At first, I had a teaching assistantship, but after that, I got a research assistantship, a post that was much more to my liking. In the new work, I would not be required to deal with students. Instead, I would be working with chemicals and lab equipment, surrounded by analytical instruments in an environment that was nearly free of contact with students. As such, it was a welcome change from the sort of work I'd been doing. Although I enjoyed working with students, the lab offered different challenges, and I soon began to think of it as the place where I really flourished. In the lab, the ironclad laws of science governed an otherwise chaotic world of actions and reactions. In the world at large, and particularly regarding my relationship with Joyce, things were more obscure and complicated. It was often hard for me to know exactly where I stood or what I should do at any particular moment. The lab, on the other hand, was a place where I felt safe in my judgments, secure in my expertise. Outside it, I felt far less certain of myself, far less able to perceive things correctly. As a result, I stayed at the lab not only because there was a great deal of work, but because I felt relief and comfort in the fact that I could adequately understand what went on there, that I understood the laws that governed things. Meanwhile, Joyce remained at home at Pamel Court. We had found the house in a very unwholesome state when we had arrived, and Joyce had resentfully knuckled down to the task of doing far more cleaning and scrubbing than she had anticipated. Once again, she found herself more or less locked away at home, while I spent my days, and now a good deal of my nights, at work in the laboratory. As a result, her emotional state began to deteriorate. A recurrent dream plagued her, one in which she was continually being chased by a large black bear. She sometimes screamed in her sleep. At times, I would try to calm her, making the typical suggestions of an analytic mind, recommending that she walk around a bit or drink a glass of warm milk, but never moving to engage the actual dream or the roots from which it sprang. Predictably, our arguments became more heated, and at times physical. On some occasions, when I would fight back vigorously, Joyce would seize a kitchen knife and make jabbing motions. In response, I would go into another room or leave the house altogether. But if Joyce and I were having a great deal of trouble with each other, we were also having problems with Jeff. Several times during those years, he fell victim to various infections. Almost every week seemed to bring another round of illness. He often contracted ear and throat infections, which would keep him crying through the night. Over and over, he was taken to the university clinic for injections, and after a time, his little buttocks were covered with injection lumps, and he began to lash out at the nurses and doctors who labored to treat him. But there were good times, too. Times when Jeff was healthy and vigorous and full of fun. We went to parades and festivals, and Ames had its own small zoo, which we occasionally visited. I set up a swing set beside our house and made a sandbox for Jeff to play in when the weather was such that he could stay outdoors. Through it all, Jeff remained a happy, ebullient child. When I arrived at home for supper, he would come rushing to me and jump into my arms. He was eager and expressive, and he loved to play and to be read to in the evening. He played with large blocks now and rode a small tricycle. Even more, he loved for me to take him riding on a bicycle, his body seated on the chrome handlebars. On one of those rides, Jeff suddenly demanded that I stop immediately. He was quite excited, his eyes very wide as he fixed them on something I could not make out. When I brought the bicycle to a halt, he pointed up ahead and to the right. "Look," he said. "Look at that." "What?" I said, still unable to see what he was pointing at. "It's right there," Jeff cried. I looked more closely in the direction he indicated and saw a small mound that looked like little more than a clump of dirt. When I drew closer, I saw that it was a nighthawk that had fallen from its nest and now lay helplessly on the hard pavement. We parked the bike and went closer. At first, we didn't know what to do, but at Jeff's urging, I picked it up and together we took it home. Over the next few weeks, we nursed it to health, feeding it a mixture of milk and corn syrup, which we served by means of a baby bottle. After a time, the bird took solid food, bread, and finally small bits of hamburger. It grew larger and larger, and we finally took it outside to release it. It was a bright spring day, and I can still remember how green everything looked. I cradled the bird in my cupped hand, lifted it into the air, then opened my hand and let it go. As it spread its wings and rose into the air, we, all of us, Joyce, Jeff, and myself, felt a wonderful delight. Jeff's eyes were wide and gleaming. It may have been the single happiest moment of his life. Chapter 2. When I was a little boy, I developed an obsession. Slowly, over time, I became fixated upon, in a sense hypnotized by, the physical presence of fire. There was an old man who lived only three or four houses down from my childhood home. He had a wooden leg and smoked a pipe. When he wanted to smoke his pipe, he struck the necessary match on his wooden leg. As a child, I saw him do it many times, and I think that perhaps my early obsession with fire stemmed from this single, curious, and often repeated event. For whatever cause, and in response to whatever developing obsession, my fixation grew over the years. For a time, I had a large matchbook collection. Still later, I began the practice of stealing matches. I'd snatch them from wherever I found them, lying on a table or tucked away in a drawer. Then I'd sneak away to some deserted spot and strike them one by one and gaze intently, as if transfixed by the dancing flames. As it remained in its early stages, my father never knew of my fixation with fire. Holding down two jobs, one as a high school math teacher and the other as a barber, he was a busy man. He knew only what most fathers know about their children. He knew when they were sick, when they had been physically hurt, and when they had triumphed or failed in some important matter. My father, of course, did not know anything of my inner life. He did not know, for example, that at times during the school day, I began experiencing new and mysterious to me sensations as I climbed the jungle gym or the parallel bars or as I rubbed up against bathroom stalls. He did not know that I later fantasized about ample, buxom women. These are the sorts of things, of course, that fathers rarely know about their growing sons, the private world of their developing sexual needs, the twists they take as they find ways of satisfying them. Nevertheless, my father was very involved in his role as parent, particularly so given the general approach to fatherhood at the time, which was to be somewhat distant, a figure whose primary function was to provide for the necessities and maintain discipline. He made time for me. He helped me with my homework and attended all the necessary parent-teacher conferences at my school. He played catch with me, took me swimming, sledding, and camping. At Christmas, he made sure I visited Santa at the local department store. He was, then, a good father, as caring and concerned as any son could wish. But there were things he didn't know, and one of them was that his son had begun to drift, helplessly and innocently drift, toward a fixation which had, in its most dreadful form, the potential for a vast and unfathomable destruction. And so I continued with my obsession. It grew larger and began to include a fascination with bombs, with the making of explosives. Still, it was fire that haunted me until, while indulging my obsession one summer afternoon, I very nearly burned down a neighbor's garage. Then at last my father learned that there were dangerous impulses in me, that somewhere, without knowing why or how, a dark pathway had been dug into my brain. What followed was a stern lecture on the dangers of fire, on its destructive power, on how careful I had to be in the future to control an interest which, if uncontrolled, would inevitably lead to acts of enormous harm. I remember listening to my father's severe warning. I remember thinking that I had gone astray, that I had somehow picked up a fascination that could have terrible consequences. More than anything, I remember thinking that it was an interest which I absolutely had to channel and control, even if it took every ounce of will. When I remember my father's reaction to my obsession with fire, I see it as incredibly old-fashioned. It was nothing more than a stern rebuke, a warning that was based upon my father's own confident notion that my fascination with fire was one I could control by means of my will alone. It would never have occurred to him that such a fascination might attach itself to my sexuality, that it might hook on to that relentlessly driving engine, and that if it did, my will would be crushed beneath it like a small twig beneath a roaring train. His naivete protected him from such dark imaginings. I think my naivete protected me, as well, from an early uneasiness about what might have been developing in my son. In the late fall of 1964, when Jeff was 4 years old and we were still living at Pamel Court, I noticed a smell which very clearly came from beneath the house. I took a flashlight and a plastic bucket and crawled under the house to find whatever it was that was generating such an unbearable odor. A few minutes later, I located a large pile of bones, the remains of various small rodents which had probably been killed by the civets that populated the general area. It was the foul smell of the civets, a close relative of the skunk, that had invaded the house. They had used the area under our house as a place for devouring the small creatures they preyed upon at night. Within a few minutes, I had gathered up all the small animal remains I could find. It was a varied assortment of bones, white, dry, and completely fleshless, since they had been picked clean by the civets. Joyce and Jeff were waiting for me as I came out from under the house. Once on my feet again, I set the bucket down and began to talk to Joyce. I was still talking to her a few minutes later when I glanced down and saw Jeff as he sat on the ground only a few feet away. He had taken a great many of the bones from the bucket and was staring at them intently. From time to time he would pick a few of them up, then let them fall with a brittle crackling sound that seemed to fascinate him. Over and over he would pick up a fistful of bones, then let them drop back into the pile that remained on the bare ground. I went over to him, and as I bent down to gather up the bones and throw them away, Jeff released another small cluster of bones and let them clatter to the ground. He seemed oddly thrilled by the sound they made. "Like fiddlesticks," he said. Then he laughed and walked away. In the last few years, I have often thought of my son as he looked that afternoon, his small hands dug deep into a pile of bones. I can no longer view it simply as a childish episode, a passing fascination. It may have been nothing more than that, but now I have to see it in a different way, in a more sinister and macabre light. It was once nothing more than a rather sweet memory of my little boy, but now it has the foretaste of his doom, and comes to me, as it often does, on the thin edge of a chill. This same sense of something dark and shadowy, of a malicious force growing in my son, now colors almost every memory I have of his childhood. In a sense, his childhood no longer exists. Everything is now a part of what he did as a man. Because of that, I can no longer distinguish the ordinary from the forbidding, trivial events from ones loaded with foreboding. When he was 4 and pointed to his belly button and asked what would happen if someone cut it out, was that merely an ordinary question from a child who had begun to explore his own body? Or was it a sign of something morbid already growing in his mind? When, at 6, Jeff broke several windows out in an old, abandoned building, was that only a typical boyhood prank? Or was it the early signal of a dark and impulsive destructiveness? When we went fishing, and he seemed captivated by the gutted fish, staring intently at the brightly colored entrails, was that a child's natural curiosity? Or was it a harbinger of the horror that was later to be found in apartment 213? In me, of course, an early obsession with fire had led to nothing more unusual than chemistry, to a lifelong work in scientific research. Jeff's momentary fascination with bones might just as easily have pointed to an early interest that might have led eventually to medicine or medical research. It might have led to orthopedics, or anatomical drawing or sculpture. It might simply have led to taxidermy. Or, more likely, it might have pointed to absolutely nothing and been forgotten. But now, I will never be able to forget it. Now, it is an early suggestion, whether actual or not, of a subtle direction in my son's thought. At the time, however, I hardly thought of it at all. And so, to the extent that I gave Jeff any early guidance, at least as far as his future interests might be, it was toward the sciences, particularly chemistry. Not long after I had discarded the animal remains I'd found beneath our house, I took Jeff to my chemistry laboratory for the first time. We walked from home, his hand in mine, as we moved down the narrow dirt road that led from our house to the university's metallurgy building. My lab was on the 3rd floor, at the end of a long corridor. It was on a weekend, and so, for the most part, Jeff and I had the run of the laboratory. For the next hour, I showed Jeff as much as I could of my work, introducing him to what, for me, were the fascinations of chemistry. I did the acid-base litmus test, and Jeff watched attentively as the paper turned either red or blue. He stared wonderingly as a beaker of phenolphthalein turned dark pink when I introduced ammonia into the solution. The steady click of the Geiger counter briefly amused him. But at the same time, he asked no questions and seemed more or less indifferent to the laboratory atmosphere. It was a day's outing, nothing more, and when it was over, he appeared no more interested in the mechanics of science than he might have been in a light show or a fireworks display. He was a child enjoying the company of his father, and when our time in the lab was over and we strolled back down the dirt road toward home, he bounced along beside me with the same energy and playfulness that he had shown as we had walked to the lab earlier in the day. There was no suggestion that he had developed even the most fleeting interest in anything I had shown him. Nothing in the vast array of laboratory equipment, the walls of bottled chemicals, the glittering cabinets filled with tubes and vials and beakers, nothing in all that had managed to captivate him with anything like the power of old bones like fiddlesticks. During the next year, while I struggled to finish my Ph.D., I watched Jeff grow larger and more animated. He remained playful, but his play had begun to take on a definite pattern. He didn't care for any form of competition and shunned games that involved physical contact. He didn't engage in scuffling or other forms of childhood wrestling. Instead, he preferred games whose rules were highly defined and non-confrontational, games full of repetitious actions, particularly those that were generally based on themes of stalking and concealment, games like hide-and-seek, kick the can, and ghost in the graveyard. Sometimes, when I would come home from the lab to grab a quick supper before returning to it, I would see Jeff crouching behind a tree or hiding behind bushes. At those moments, he seemed totally absorbed, so I rarely made the effort to break his concentration by calling to him or waving as I walked into the house. Instead, I let him go, had my supper, and left seconds later, bent upon my own obsession, which was, perhaps, no less intense than his. Once at the lab, I became absorbed in my own work. I was never a great student. What others got quickly took me much longer. I was a plodder, a plugger, a hard worker. For me, anything less than an all-out effort would mean failure. Others had flashes of creative brilliance, of sudden illumination, but I had only the power of my own will. During our time at Pamel Court, I exercised that will to the fullest. My Ph.D. work became, quite literally, my life. I thought of almost nothing else. Inevitably, then, other parts of my life began to blur. Joyce blurred, and so did Jeff. I saw him in glimpses, a boy shooting around the room or eating at the dinner table. I felt him in snatches, a quick hug on the way in or out. I spoke to him in brief hellos, in goodbyes tossed over my shoulder as I left the room. The Ph.D. loomed before me like an enormous mountain. Everything else seemed small. But Jeff was not small. He was getting bigger every day. Still, I barely saw him grow, barely glimpsed the changes that were creeping over him. And so it was not until Jeff suddenly became ill that I was brought to a full stop. The illnesses that had plagued Jeff during the early years of his life had gone away as he had grown older. He seemed healthy and robust, a normal kid in every way. Then, suddenly, he was stricken. One day in the spring of 1964, Jeff began to complain about an area of tenderness in his groin area. This tenderness worsened, and a small bulge appeared in his scrotum. We took him to the doctor right away, and he was subsequently diagnosed as suffering from a double hernia. The doctor explained that the hernia was the result of a birth defect and that surgery was necessary to correct the problem. Surgery was scheduled for the following week, and while Joyce and I stood by, Jeff selected the ragged, floppy-eared dog he had slept with since the age of 2 as the stuffed animal he wished to accompany him to the hospital. The operation was performed shortly after, and when it was over, Jeff was taken to his room, where he remained sedated for several hours. When he awoke, of course, it was to a great deal of pain. So much pain, I learned later, that he had asked Joyce if the doctors had cut off his penis. He remained in the hospital for several days, and even after he had returned home, his recovery seemed to move forward slowly. For long hours, he remained on the sofa in the living room, his body wrapped in a large, checkered bathrobe. During that period, he moved slowly, ponderously, like an old man. The ebullience which had marked his childhood, his buoyancy and energy, drained away. During any period of recovery, of course, a certain flattening of mood could be expected. But in Jeff, this flattening began to take on a sense of something permanent. He seemed smaller, somehow more vulnerable, perhaps even sadder than at any time before. By the fall of 1966, when our time at Pamel Court was coming to an end, this strange and subtle inner darkening began to appear almost physically. His hair, which had once been so light, grew steadily darker, along with the deeper shading of his eyes. More than anything, he seemed to grow more inward, sitting quietly for long periods, hardly stirring, his face oddly motionless. Now, when I look at photographs of my son at this age, I can't help but wonder if strange shapes were already forming in his mind, odd notions that he himself could not understand, vague fantasies that might have frightened even him, but which he could not keep at bay. In the pictures, I can see only a kid playing in the yard or sitting silently with his dog, but I wonder if, even as he did those things, he was already sinking into a world that was invisible to me. I wonder if the world of monsters which other children were beginning to cast aside was in my son, growing larger and more hideously populated with each passing day. As for me, I saw only a quiet little boy, who at least after we left Pamel Court appeared more withdrawn than before, more inward, less likely to flash his quick, warm smile. It is possible that I didn't see anything more than that because I was rushing past my son too quickly. Sometimes, almost from the corner of my eyes, I would glimpse my son as he sat on the sofa, staring blankly at the flickering television. I can't remember the look on his face or recall to any degree the light in his eyes. More seriously, I can't recall noticing that some earlier light was slowly going out, and so I wasn't there to see him as he began to sink into himself. I wasn't there to sense, even if I could have sensed it, that he might be drifting toward that unimaginable realm of fantasy and isolation that it would take me nearly 30 years to recognize. And yet, it may have been happening even then, while I gulped down my dinner and bolted past him for the door, comforted by the notion that I was the only member of our family who was going out into the night.
Katherine Massey, Book Club, Context of White Supremacy, audio segment number one. If you have thoughts, observations, questions, let us know. The number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Email untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. Let us know if you have thoughts, observations. So again, cannot stress enough. I didn't even want to read this book, which is odd now, but whatever. I didn't even want to read this book. But what is the point of having a book club? I am certain, I don't know, maybe they stuff so many of us in remedial education and on the computers and such. Maybe we do have lots of us who do not remember. But at least for myself, frequently in school, all the way up talking college level, you do comparison, contrast, right? You read this book, come back and read the next book, especially if it's on similar subject matter. That was really the deciding factor in why we read this book at this moment. Compare and contrast. We can be real counter-racist literary scholars. Anybody, you do any sort of project, you write a counter-racist report, you do a counter-racist video, counter-racist audio recording, whatever it is, whatever you can think of, we will promote, share, compare, contrast these two memoirs, A Mother's Reckoning, A Father's Story, in the context of white supremacy, and especially since they're directly related, both of these killings happening in the 90s, white families, and then the Columbine cowards, directly influenced by Jeffrey Dahmer. Duh. Tons of parallels already. We will pile them up as we go. Let's see. That way, and that way too, my thinking also was that way. We do not forget, we just spent all that time invested in Columbine. That is not just kick to the curb and move forward. No way. So keep that in mind, and particularly what we just heard from Sue Klebold. Even so, does this book sound the same in terms of all of the deflection that we thought we heard, lying that went on? It's not my fault. Don't blame that. Hey, I don't know what to do. That sort of thing. I mean, it'll be lots to be mindful of as we read. Obviously, a little different, context, because we didn't spend 2 or 3 months reading and studying about Jeffrey Dahmer prior to reading this memoir, but I don't know. Lots of people have, you know, looked at, heard, read about Dahmer. I don't know. People can tell us that as we're going through. Have you read, is this the first time anyone has seriously read anything about Dahmer? I know I briefly studied his bio when we had Robert Dvorak on the program, but that was some years ago, and I needed to do an extensive dive. But I mean, Robert Dvorak, so that's one. And I did look at a few other sources at that time, but not as, I mean, they're like thousands of studies and books and dissertations on the Milwaukee cannibal, J. Dahmer. Let's see, I'll give one email. You have no idea. It was so difficult for me to pick a book this time. Wow. I waited, I think, until this morning to, all right, we're going to do the Dahmer book. But, man, even listeners indulged my indecisiveness. Different book that I was thinking about reading. Narrator lined up, and even have the narration, bang, ready to roll. If I had changed my mind to pick that book, I was indulged even with that. Much obliged to listeners for that. But we are already picked for next book. This is short, so as soon as we're done, October 19, moving forward. Let's see. Person, get email number one, then we'll get to some of the callers. Let's see. Email number one. I'm interested, of course, in whether there are similarities to Sue's book. Why we're reading all this to begin with. We'll be on high alert for deceptions and deflections. Given all the obsession by the white collective regarding Dahmer books, movies, articles, documentaries, could this text be the most revealing? I don't know. We shall see. Forward. Number one, selling hundreds of thousands of dollars. I had no idea this was such a popular book. Me either. Real talk, this book was published in 1994. I had no idea this book existed until, it was within the last 12 months. I remember I found this like, what? Jeffrey Dahmer? What? This would be another reason why. No, we're not going to read any fiction. Let's get Jeffrey Dahmer's dad's book. Two, make some small changes, subtle, not so subtle distortions in previous editions. This on some level seems like an attempt at minimizing of incorrectness, distortions, or simply lies. They better clearly point out the discrepancies. That might be interesting too, if we can get the 1994 edition and then do a compare and contrast to see what exactly got changed over that time. Certainly his son, you know, died between now and then, so that would be one update. Acknowledgement, which were not read in the audio. One, treated Jeff like a human being. Captain M. Gurick, gently breaking the details, extremely gracious and humane treatment towards Jeff, Sherry, and me, kind and helpful neighbors. This seems very reminiscent of the behavior of enforcement officials and neighbors in the last text. Maybe it should be called Circling the Wagons to preserve white supremacy. I said the same thing. The acknowledgments were not read, but when I was reading them to myself, like, wow, did you all get roast beef sandwiches? People came and stuffed C notes into your pocket. We got you, you know, Brother Dahmer. We got you, brother. We know Jeff had some brain power. We got you, brother. Just let us know. We got sweet potato pie coming. Like, man, doesn't matter. He ate up the people? What? Come on, part one. The part which should have made him think about the misery he was calling, this part is alive in most people. Everyone is vain, egocentric. We call it conscience. So everyone has a little murderous psychopath in them. They just don't act upon it. Chapter 1. I think of my wife's need for love and my inability to show it. Is this setting the stage for the excuse that Jeffy became a murdering psychopath because Daddy didn't show him enough love? Guess it's possible. 2. Smell of our neighbor's cooking. Uncontrollable muscle spasms, could find no medical reason. The attacks, the noise and odors, is Joyce having an auditory olfactory hallucinations indicative of mental illness? I am not a mental health expert, but that did come to mind. I don't know. Let's see. Number three, emotional makeup, peaks and valleys. Sounds like she was bipolar to me. I'm not a mental health expert, but that could be the case. And even, I'll keep reading the notes. Four, dream chased by a large black bear. I imagine Dr. Welsing, being a psychiatrist, would have a lot to say about this dream. I was thinking the exact same thing. Not just a bear. Black bear. Quit. Five. Arguments. Physical. Fight back vigorously. Joyce seized a kitchen knife. No details about what the arguments were about. Is this deception accurate, or was she just acting in self-defense based on Lionel's aggressions? Said the arguments that they were physical. Like, what does that, like, that's not descriptive enough. Like, what does that mean? Like, you throw something? Do you shove someone? Grabbed her and put her in the headlock? Like, what is that? I would need more details. I would need more details. Because, I mean, that's a wide spectrum, just saying it was physical. I don't know. Is this irrational that she went to a knife, or is this you hit her with a brick and, yeah, I was about to get a knife. You hit me upside my head with another brick and, you know, more detail. They could have put that in with the edits. Six, Nighthawk nursed it to health. Single happiest moment of his life. This seems irresponsible. No animal control in those days. No Department of Natural Resources to take the animal to. Professionals, etc. It was the 1960s. Maybe just a different time. Could be. Not sure. I don't know. I guess some people could say, you know, they were being humane. I don't know. Science. People do experiments and such like that, too. They try and nurse. Now they put this on TikTok, right? Give you daily updates and such. They nurse him back to health and then do the release video and all that. Might get a, you know, thumbs up from the PETA people, or, you know, I don't know. People have to get, I'm not a pet person, so I don't know. So I could see some quarters where they might get a right on, attaboy, thumbs up. Chapter 2. When I was a little boy, I developed an obsession with fire, bombs, explosive. This was one of many points where I said, why did you not want to read this book again? I don't know. So, mom is bipolar and dad is a pyromaniac. Reminds one of Eric and Dill with all the fires and bombs. Yes. Yes. I do feel like I've heard some of this before. Two, civets. Never heard of this animal, mostly native to Asia and Africa, called a ringtail cat in North America. I'd never heard of that either. A ringtail? I've been to Wisconsin, but I've not, you know, hung out there for a long time, so. Three, bones like fiddlesticks, forecast of doom. Interesting anecdote given his subsequent behaviors. Suppose it could be significant. Dad thought it was. Five, I was never a great student. I doubt if a black male would accomplish a PhD in chemistry unless they were a spectacular student. The benefits of being white. I said the same thing. And I even thought the wording of it, because it reminded me, Sue never just said, this Dill dude is lazy. It was always, you know, he lacks ambition. He's deficient in his scholarly energies. You know, she always had that real creative way of saying, this dude is lazy. Same thing here. He's not lazy. He's not a dunce. He's not stupid. He's a plugger. Which, no disrespect. Everybody is not a genius. No problem. I'm not a genius myself, but just, dang, they don't generally, if you're a Negro, remedial class, get to the computers, Jamal. Leroy is generally not classified as a plugger en route to a PhD in chemistry. Just saying. I'll pause there, and we'll nab some of the callers. 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Let's see. First few folks with a hand up. Line should be open. Let's see. Commentary on a father's story. Reminders to Sue's book.
Yeah, Gus. Victor from New Jersey. So far, from what I heard, I paid attention to the bomb. So I'm just, it just seems like, you know, firearms, explosives, it's white culture. So I'm definitely seeing a parallel from that. And just real briefly, because I just have more listening to do. Brief examples of dysfunction, the mother and father, fighting in a home. So far I really don't see parallels in trying to, paint a picture, or have us believe that this is a perfect household and that Jeffrey Dahmer, you know, just kind of, it just happened without them even knowing, as it was Sue, you know, with Sue's explanation for her son, you know, they had, you know, a good upbringing. She was Jewish and, you know, brain trauma. So I don't see the father doing that just yet, like, you know, passing blame to something outside of his household. But I'm still paying attention. It seems like he's also examining how his son got to be the man that we know as Jeffrey Dahmer, the cannibal who victimized black males, non-white males. So far, that's what I'm getting from this read. So. So I'm definitely going to pay attention to this.
Okay. Have you read any books on Dahmer before? Done any, like, serious study of what happened with this here white cannibal before?
No. This would be my first time. And this is why I'm definitely going to pay close attention. If I can't call in live, I'll definitely just listen to the playback. I really was never interested in, you know, Jeffrey Dahmer. And, you know, so I'm definitely interested now. And I haven't watched the movie, the Netflix series. I just refuse to, you know, just like how I refuse to look at police shootings of black victims. I just really didn't want to be traumatized by looking at Jeffrey Dahmer and, you know, and how they kind of, like, you know, turned him into more or less like a, you know, also kind of like a sex symbol in a sense, you know, he's just fetishizing as a guy. So I definitely refuse to listen. I mean, to look at the Netflix series, but this book read, I'm definitely want to hear where he came from, what, you know, his upbringing.
Right on. Victim in New Jersey. I'm close. I did look at read the Robert Dvorak book way back when, long time ago, but nothing serious. Okay. Much obliged, a victim in New Jersey. Other folks who dialed in with a hand up, *61, if you have commentary, proceed.
Nadia.
Fresh Princess in Philly. Yes, ma'am.
Hello. Good evening, guests and callers. So, from my notes, I noted that the mother, during her pregnancy, was being prescribed barbiturates, morphine, and phenobarbital. I've seen where black women complain of pain and all types of pregnancy complications, and they get the bum's rush to the door. And they definitely don't get barbiturates, morphine, and phenobarbital. It sounds like she was an addict after a while, and her mood swings seem more like withdrawal symptoms. I noted that Jeffrey Dahmer was a junior, so it's not like his father can change his name. Like, his father made a whole life for himself, and if he has a PhD, then it means that his research and his work and things like that are published. So if you look up Jeffrey Dahmer, you're going to find the killer and you're going to find him too. So I think this is a very apologetic sounding book. I noted that, and the contrast for me is that Sue made Eric a monster to protect her image of Dylan. But since Jeffrey Dahmer Jr. acted alone, his father had no one to place the blame on. So I think a lot of the first two chapters is him looking back at behavior, trying to figure out, like, what was the trigger? What did I miss? Whereas Sue claims, you know, she missed all the signs. The father is, like, going back, like, was that it? Was that it? Like, which was the trigger to make him do this? It seems like his wife may have had postpartum on top of some other unaddressed mental health issues. And it also sounds like they didn't know each other too well prior to them getting married. She also seemed like she was a drama queen. Like, when he often talks about him not being home all the time because of the hours he was working at, it doesn't really seem unusual. Like, 7 to 7 is pretty much the normal time that people come and go to go to work and run errands after work and whatnot. So if she needed that much attention and she couldn't figure out how to get out the house on her own and walk down the street with the baby, then that was on her. So there's a lot of self-blame in the father. I also picked up on the big black bear. That seemed weird because it's like, where have you seen a bear in Milwaukee? A big black one at that. Jeff Sr. appears to blame his absence for Joyce's behavior. And because of how he viewed his father's parenting style as being more of a provider than a nurturing father. I noted that Caucasian people are playing with bombs and fire a lot, but I have my own, I guess, relationship to that as someone who went further in the sciences academically as a child. I did set a lot of fires and experimented on insects and plants in my parents' house, and I did destroy many things. And I am also not the sharpest tool in the drawer, but I am a plugger. I did not make it to the PhD level, but I have 2 master's degrees. I have 1 in biotechnology and an MBA. But I did plug away, like, very hard. It took me a lot of effort. I noted that Jeffrey Dahmer Sr.'s father noted his son's behavior and tried to check it, but I think the difference is that Jeff Dahmer Sr. wasn't a psychopath or a sociopath, so he didn't want to, like, cause destruction, and his father's disappointment, you know, changed his view of what he was doing because he didn't want to hurt anybody. Whereas if you look at Dylan, when he went to the diversion program, he knew his parents were hurt and devastated by it, but yet he was plotting something totally more sinister in the background to, like, murder a whole bunch of people. So he wasn't affected enough by the theft to change his ways and actually be remorseful and take the program seriously. He was really just doing it as a cover for the other things he had planned. So that's my commentary. Thank you for allowing me to speak.
Wow, great point about the difference in treatment that pregnant black mommies like Serena Williams not that long ago received, since we want to talk about class. Lots and lots of dough, cowbell. Difference in treatment. They don't just get to go and pick any old kind of drugs and what have you that they think will be best to relieve their symptoms or discomfort or whatever is going on. Incidentally, phenobarbital is a class 4 controlled substance used for its sedative and anti-seizure properties in patients with status epileptics and alcohol withdrawal management. It is known for being highly addictive. In fact, found to be a common agent of choice for suicide attempts. Wow, that is... Wow. that gave me pause as well for old Joyce, Mother Joyce. I think Fresh Princess did say addictive. Maybe his mom had some sort of addictive habits and what have you while she was going through her mothering stages in Whatall. Could be. Did you have a copy of the Anarchist cookbook, Fresh Princess, before we get our next caller? Just saying.
No, I didn't buy one. But I knew somebody who had it. And they hung out on the phone. So. And they said marijuana. I just, you know, you meet people.
That's from the folks who do not participate in gym. Bombs to make. We don't do laps. Other folks who dialed in, if you have commentary to share, proceed.
May I be heard?
Lauren, yes, ma'am.
Hello. Good evening, everyone. I'm really hopeful about this book. I think it was an excellent choice, Beth. You had a man on the program. His name was Robert Dvorak. I heard that program. It was actually one of the first times I heard you interview anyone that wasn't Dr. Welsing or Mr. Fuller. This was a couple of years ago, and I thought that program was so interesting. So, you know, that program is one of the first college programs I heard, and then I did read that book that he wrote called Milwaukee Massacre. So there's that. About the segment, give me a second. Let me try to get to my notes. Taking me a little while over here. I don't know what the heck is. Okay. All right. So about the segment that was played today, he started, he was talking about giving a portion of the profits from this book to the victims of his son. So, you know, I asked myself the question, you know, I wondered how much money he's given to these victims of racism, white supremacy, that his son killed. Let me see. He also said, I am confident you will find this book engaging and valuable reading. I hope that's an accurate prediction. It said, I'm very grateful that William Morrow and Paul allowed me the opportunity to explore the relationships intertwining my background with Jeff's, to shed some light on how he developed, and to show that he was not, as some people insist, born a monster. So if he wasn't born a monster, this is the implication that he turned into one. If that is the implication, how did he turn into one? And, you know, whom encouraged such a transition? You know, is it just being in a system of racism, white supremacy, or is it being produced and taught to behave by other practitioners of racism, white supremacy that turns a person into this kind of individual? Let me see. So I don't think it was read on the audiobook version, but there is a quote at the beginning of the book. It says, in deep and awful channels runs this sympathy for sire and son. And that was from William Wordsworth. So, you know, it made me wonder if this is one of the reasons that Lionel Dahmer produced this text. Is it to get the reader to feel sympathy for him and his son? Also, I'm wondering, does he go by the name Lionel Dahmer, or is that something that he started doing after his son became famous for killing and eating all of those people? It said, after that, I would have tried. He talked about, like, when the police came to his house and told him what Jeff did. And he was saying, you know, if the police had told me that my son was dead, I would have thought differently about him. I would have tried to think of my son warmly. I would have, I hope, visited his grave from time to time, spoken of him with loss and affection, continued as much as possible to be the custodian of his memory. You know, he's saying he would have done all those things if the police would have told him the same thing that they told the victims. So I guess we can read this book and see if Lionel speaks of his son warmly. if he speaks of him with loss and affection and continues to be custodian of his memory, we can be on the lookout for those things. Also, it said, predictably, as the evidence accumulated and became increasingly ghastly, I made myself believe that Jeff could not have done such things on his own, but that he had acted only as the tool of someone else, someone more evil than my son, someone who had taken advantage of Jeff's loneliness and isolation and had turned him into a terrible slave. Slave, that's interesting. I conjured visions of this other that were probably as satanic as the ones in Jeff's imagination. The other was an evil genius and manipulator, a diabolical Svengali who had lured my son into the circle of his power and then converted him into a mindless demon. That was an interesting passage, and the use of the word satanic made me think of that lady who was on the program the other day, Dr. Nikki Falkoff from South Africa. He was talking about the people in the apartment building, and he said, but none of them had ever had the slightest suspicion of the horrors that lay behind that closed door. How does he know that? Like, it seems like somebody in that apartment building would have connected the smell that was coming from Jeffrey Dahmer's apartment with a dead body or bodies. I mean, that smell was complained about. And I don't think he went and talked to all the people who lived in Jeffrey Dahmer's apartment building. It just seems presumptuous, in my view. In the beginning, that was my most profound admission that there was something missing in Jeff, the part that should have cried out, stop. So, you know, it sounds like he's describing that Jeffrey Dahmer just doesn't care about people. He lacks sensitivity. You know, he doesn't really care about other people's pain. And that seems like a common characteristic of white people. Also, I noted that when he was talking about him and his wife living in that apartment and she's complaining about the smells and people making noise with their pots and pans, you know, that seems like super, you know, normal stuff you smell when other people are cooking food and things like that when you live in an apartment building. And it says she grew increasingly irritable at my refusal to complain to our neighbors. And it made me wonder if it was a common characteristic, like if that was something super common that white women do, like tell their husbands to go cause conflict because of something that they're feeling. And then she would ask me if I loved her, and I would always reassure her, even though these reassurances never seemed to satisfy her. You know, again, I guess this is, you know, it's really common. People use this word very often, love. And I used to use this word a lot too, but now every time I hear it, I don't know what it means. And, you know, whenever I ask people, I don't get an answer that I can easily understand, you know, something that makes sense. So I really would like people to start, you know, just giving me some idea of what love means when this term is used in a system of white supremacy. He talked a lot kind of about his, okay. He said, when I think of these moments now, I think of my wife's need for love and my inability to show it in a way that would have been meaningful to her. I showed love by working. I showed love by working, by striving, by attending to her every physical need, by moving toward a future which I expected to share with her. This was not what she needed, of course, but it was all that I could give. Thinking analytically, which is the way I tend to think, I saw myself as a dutiful husband, a provider of the essentials, food, clothing, shelter, the kind of man my father had been, which served as my only model for what a husband should be. This is super interesting. And already I think he's being more honest than Sue Klebold was. You know, her whole book was just, you know, hey, I was a great parent, you know, Dylan was a wonderful kid. You know, there's no way I could have known. But, you know, we're right at the beginning and he's already telling us about things that he lacked. And he's done that a couple of times. So you know, him saying that he couldn't connect with his wife in an emotional manner. So he just worked and tried to pay bills. And that's the way his father was. I think this, you know, a piece of super interesting and important information. Just you know, his lack of emotions, it's more honest. That's all I'm saying, to compare and contrast. The things that the mom wrote after Jeffrey Dahmer was born, she wrote, "Chemistry has many faces, with chemists in a fuss. Well, here's our little formula patented by us." I thought that was noteworthy. White people do seem to have the patent on producing people like Jeffrey Dahmer. When he finds the bones under the house and he's like playing with them, you know, and throws them down to fiddlesticks and, you know, just the things he did when he was a little boy, you know, like the wooden blocks. And he said he played with the usual stuffed toys, bunnies and dogs, with wooden blocks, and he loved to stack carefully and then push them over with a sudden powerful thrust. In the fall, while in his playpen, he would sometimes gather up the surrounding leaves and begin to tear them fiercely. Once when I asked him what he was doing, he replied simply, "We'll cut the leaves," which means ripping the leaves. Then he smiled. You know, I might be reading too much into this. Lots of kids, you know, knock down blocks and whatever. But I kind of, they seemed like examples of building up in order to tear down. And I think that is something that racists do quite a bit of. The shots in his little rear end when he was a baby, I was wondering if that's how antibiotics are typically administered to children. I'm not sure. I don't have any children. I don't know. I have a lot of notes. I don't want to talk for too long, but so far it's pretty interesting. And I think you made a solid choice on this. Oh, wait. Okay, wait, one more thing. When he goes to the hospital, okay, it says, "One day in the spring of 1964, Jeff began to complain about an area of tenderness in his groin area. This tenderness worsened and a small bulge appeared in his scrotum." You know, he tells a story and then, you know, they go to the hospital, okay? And then it says, "The operation was performed shortly after, and when it was over, Jeff was taken to his room where he remained sedated for several hours. When he awoke, of course, it was to a great deal of pain. So much pain, I learned later that he had to ask Joyce if the doctors had cut off his penis." Now, I heard that before. I didn't, you know the entire story, but I heard him wondering about his penis being missing. So I took note of that. And I said he remained in the hospital for several days, and even after he'd returned home, his recovery seemed to move forward slowly. For long hours, he remained on the sofa in the living room, his body wrapped in a large checkered bathrobe. During that period, he moved slowly, ponderously, like an old man. The ebullience which had marked his childhood, his buoyancy and energy drained away. During any period of recovery, of course, a certain flattening of mood could be expected. But in Jeff, this flattening began to take on a sense of something permanent. He seemed smaller, somehow more vulnerable, perhaps even sadder than at any time before. And so I was wondering, you know, I did the math on that, because I don't think it said he was 4 years old when he went to the hospital. But Jeffrey Dahmer was born in 1960. He went to the hospital in 1964. So it made me wonder, did they just take him to the hospital and drop him off? Or did somebody stay with him the entire time? That same thing happened to Ted Kaczynski, and after he went to the hospital, his mom says he was never the same. So, you know, I kind of made that connection in my mind to another famous maker of death, and that's all I have for right now. Thank you for allowing me to speak.
AKA the Unabomber. Yes, that is an important part of the story, and just from what we've heard, it wouldn't be surprising, I think I could phrase it that way, based on what we've heard in the teaspoon of reading so far, if his dad was off at Marquette working on his PhD, plugging away, mom is popping pills or having her ups and downs and, you know, whatever. Yeah, and even for that time period, yeah, it could have been he just got dropped off and, you know, they get to check on him when they check on him briefly and, you know, shoot away type of a thing. Something to consider for sure. But we'll keep all that kind of in mind as we proceed. Let me see. I guess I was going to get my notes because I had some of the similar notes as Lawrence. I could kind of overlap as we go. But while she was sharing, I looked to get some of the reviews, because this came up last time, talking about how people perceive this book, how they think about these parents who write these books. Said last time, Sue Klebold, beloved, thousands of reviews on Amazon, and most of them two thumbs up. Same thing for this book. You heard, no lower than $50 once it was out of print, and now they got it back in print, so you can get it readily. Said it was always popular, even when it was scarce. No surprise there. This is from the LA Times, 2002, February 27, Black History Month. A dark reflection, an accusing glare, is often cast on the parents of those who kill and who have outraged the public. Excuse. So it reads, I'm not going to read the whole thing. I'll just pick out the pertinent portions. The latest set of parents to feel the sting of blame are those of John Walker Lynn. Though the American Taliban has not been charged with killing anyone and has not pleaded guilty to the charges he took up arms against his country, he has been reviled as much as some murderers. Let's see, what parent could possibly be prepared when a child is suddenly thrust into the headlines in the most negative way? Not only must they grapple with their own horror and anguish, they must do so under the hot lights of the national media. The costs can be enormous. The tab for the legal defense in such cases can run into the hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not millions. Friendships vanish overnight. Sue told us about that. Ties with relatives are severed and marriages shattered. Sue and Tom got divorced. Grief, guilt, and relentless second-guessing ensue. Why didn't I catch this? What did I do wrong? How could this happen? It can crystallize into an often overwhelming depression. Parents of notorious children rarely talk publicly. Email or phone calls to more than a dozen such parents, including those of Lynn, Jeffrey Dahmer, and students who have shot classmates, were not returned. Such reluctance is not surprising, report psychologists and sociologists who have worked with families. Parents battle enormous shame, and retelling the details to the public through the media is simply too painful for most. There can be compelling legal restraints as well. The parents of Dylan Klebold, who was one of the two teens to shoot 13 classmates at Columbine High School in Colorado, 12 students and one teacher technically, are facing a number of pending lawsuits totaling $300 million and have been advised not to say a word, says James Garbarino, author of Parents Under Siege. Garbarino was the only person outside of law enforcement to interview the Klebolds. Polls clearly revealed the propensity to blame the parents for the sins of the child. A Gallup poll taken shortly after the 1999 Columbine rampage showed that 84% of respondents faulted parents, at least in part, for the tragedy. Meanwhile, a CBS News poll at the time found 40% believed that parents were not only to blame, but were the chief reason for the shootings. Skipping down, the Klebolds didn't abuse or neglect their child. They were involved and loving, said Garbarino, who dedicated his book to them, but it raises questions of why bad things happen to good parents. Skipping down a little bit, Rosemary Martinez, mother of Michael McDermott, a mentally ill veteran who gunned down 7 people at his workplace near Boston in 2000, reported she was in tears after receiving letters, flowers, and hugs from neighbors. Even Lionel Dahmer, father of notorious serial killer Jeffrey, found empathy on his first day back to work after his son's 1991 arrest. A co-worker said, "There, but for the grace of God, go I." I can't do no more. Woo. Man. I was not prepared for that one. I had to remind myself, what did Jeff do? Oh, he was eating the people. I don't... maybe you could have said that to Sue. Like, maybe my child could run wild. And, I mean, hey, we got old deviant gym flunker Fresh Princess making bombs and such. So, hey, I don't know. I guess everybody could have a child to run wild and blow up the school. But kidnapping children and eating them? Could have been me, Brother Lionel. It's good to see you back, brother. Welcome in. I can't get my head up. I can't. Whew. It was more about the Klebolds after that, but I mean, I don't even know it. This is in the LA Times. I thought, and then, see, and they come back and say that, oh, it's so hard. Oh, the shame of it all. What? What are you talking about? It's hugs. All I needed was the roast beef sandwich. We go, oh, that's the same thing. You got your $100 and everything? Your $100 bills, excuse me. You got your $100 bills and your roast beef sandwich? Okay, you good to go. Let's see. There, but for the grace of God, go I, Brother Lionel. Oh, this is in the book? Jesus, Lord, I hopped ahead. This is in the book. We'll get to that later, I guess. Tenderness is far from the norm, more plentiful, particularly in the case of the Dahmers and the Klebolds, are harassing phone calls late at night, angry letters, threats against their home and even their lives, all of which can lead to the need for police protection. What? I don't recall hearing none of that in Sue Klebold's book. Did you all hear? Did we miss that? Harassing phone calls? She didn't say anything about that. Angry that she didn't see, she said the letters were vetted. Threats against their home with the leaky pool and cracked tennis courts and the rats? I don't, show cause, brother, show cause. Martin Miller, show cause for any of this. Hopefully, we'll see if any of this comes up in Lionel Dahmer's book, if he was threatened or, you know, whatever the case. Let me look at my notes really quick, and then we'll get to audio section two. Let's see. So Brother Lionel says from the very beginning that he's donating a portion of the proceeds. Now, Sue Klebold just said up front, you know, all the proceeds going to mental health. We'll give a teaspoon to presumably lots of the black family members. We'll give them a teaspoon. Okay. Let's see. Reader interest, however, never disappeared. No one here said that they already read this book. They already had it. No one said that. So I'm going to suspect that it was a lot of white people who read this book. Maybe, hey, this book was published in 94. Reb and Vodka could have read this book. Let's see. Hundreds of dollars for a single copy. I'm not surprised at all. And that would again tell me who is reading this book, who has $200-$300 to get a book about a cannibal white racist. Let's see. Dahmer's, Lionel Dahmer lived to 84 at least. I have to check to see if he's still alive. And this was in 2021, time that this was written. Man, Woody Allen get to live to a long age. Even Carolyn Bryant Donham, who just passed away, she lived well into her 80s. System of White Supremacy, you get that long life. My man J. Strom Thurmond lived over 100. Good health benefits to be classified as white. Let's see. He gets classified as brave for writing this book. That's very similar to what they said about Sue Klebold. I don't know. You get to make a lot of money. Sue Klebold gets to go out and give a lot of speaking engagements. Have to see. I know Lionel Dahmer did go on the Larry King live show. So, I don't know. I mean, a lot of people, they would be happy to go, you know, to get to go TV programs and talk about themselves, write a book or what have you. I'm sure they wouldn't want to have to talk about their murdering child. But for a lot of people, like, hey, you know, it's my moment, you know, get my good clothes, do my thing. Let's see. Acknowledgements. He talks about the people who hooked it up for him. First person who wrote in already mentioned that. Let's see. Definitely sympathy for he and Jeff. I'm not sure either I forgot or I'm not sure I knew at all that old Jeff Dahmer had a satanic altar with the Negro corpses. Like, that was a pause. Like, oof, hopefully we'll get into the details of all of that. And when he says, my son was still alive, I couldn't bury him, I couldn't remember him fondly. I think Lauren was alluding to this. We'll have to see if that's true as we proceed through the book. Does it seem like he is fondly remembering his child? Because it seemed like Sue, she had boatloads of fond memories of Dill. Barbecue duck and all, remember? Let's see. I do appreciate, I think a few folks said this, maybe a teaspoon more honest than what we got from Sue. He said, as the evidence ghastly and accumulated, he said he made himself believe that Jeff could not have done all this, and he acted as a tool of someone else, that he was a slave. Lauren, I think, paid attention to that, which I said, are you, what? Come on now, Lionel, what? That should have been edited on the rewrite. That reminded me so much of Sue, but I do at least appreciate him saying, hey, I'm analytical. The evidence, like, Jeff is not a slave. This dude is a cannibal. Wow. What did I do? Like, that is quite a bit different than the tone that Sue started out with. And even his emphasis on being analytical. I would not exactly describe Sue as being an analytical person, even though she gives the veneer of that with all those quotes of white doctors and experts, like Dr. Langman, who we heard at the beginning, who forgot, oh yeah, these cowards did fixate on old Jeff Dahmer and other white serial killers. We even got a teaspoon of the brain component that we heard last time too, where he writes that it may be that this part of his brain is no more than a chemical trace or configuration of brain cells, meaning the so-called conscience, supposed to stop you from chopping up little boys and raping them and killing them. He has lots of family pictures, just like Sue Klebold. Family photos of little baby Jeff and Joyce holding him, I guess when she was in one of her better moments. Mental health, which is important, not to be joked about. The noise sensitivity reminded me of Dr. Welsing, because, hey, during pregnancy, you do get very sensitive, and noise, I mean, that is a form of pollution, for real, even something to think about before you have offspring. Even something about Lionel, I guess this will be the last thing I'll get in, and then we can get to it, but, oh, wait a minute, two, and then we'll get to it. One, his inability to confront other people, that seems to carry over to Jeff. His inability to have healthy relationships, just drug him and beat him over the head and rape him and kill him. Like, all that, like, what? Even reminded me of Tom a little bit, but Tom Klebold I'm talking about. And then West Allis, Wisconsin. These folks are moving to a lot of sundown towns. West Allis, Wisconsin today is plus 70% white and was higher at that time. I have to get into more detail about that as we proceed. And the 26 pills a day. Are you serious? 26 pills. Come on, man. If that had been a Negro person, Dorothy Roberts talked about that and killing the black bot. One, there is no way in the world they given Serena Williams or anybody else access to 26 pills a day. What? What does it mean to be white? Weren't we talking about pill popping in the last book, Sue, and her anxieties? Did we hear that two in a row? Boundless overlap. Audio segment two, A Father's Story. Lionel Dahmer, Katherine, Massey, Book Club.
I received my Ph.D. in October of 1966, and a month later I took my first job as a research chemist for a large chemical company in the Akron, Ohio area. We found a small house in Doylestown, a colonial twinplex with four white columns on the front, the largest house we had ever lived in. Joyce was pregnant again, a pregnancy that exhibited the same problems as her first. Noise was bothering her again, and she was often nervous, sleepless, and irritable. She took 2 to 3 Equinil a day to help with her condition. But they did not seem to help very much, and so the dosage was increased to 3 to 5 tablets a day. Even this increase did not ameliorate her general condition, however. The nervousness continued, and as it did, Joyce became more withdrawn until, by the time of David's birth in December of 1966, we hardly had any social life at all. During this time, of course, I spent most of my time at work at my new job. In the lab, I once again found a wonderful comfort and assurance in knowing the properties of things, how they could be manipulated in predictable patterns. It provided a great relief from the chaos I found at home, the volatility of Joyce's emotions, the continual shifts within her mood. The lab was a haven from those storms, and I probably worked even longer hours because of that. As for Jeff, he had started first grade at Hazel Harvey Elementary School in Doylestown, but he had done so reluctantly. A strange fear had begun to creep into his personality, a dread of others that was combined with a general lack of self-confidence. It was as if he had come to expect that other people might harm him in some way, and so he wanted to stay clear of them. Without doubt, the move from Pamel Court had darkened Jeff's mood considerably. Perhaps it was the fact that we had found it necessary to leave his cat behind, or perhaps it was the fact that he was already developing a reluctance to change, a need to feel the assurance of familiar places. Certainly the prospect of going to school frightened and unnerved him. He had taken on the shyness that would later become a permanent aspect of his character. His posture had become more rigid, so that he stood very erect, as if at attention, his fingers pressed tightly against the sides of his legs. On the morning of his first scheduled school day, I remember the terror that swept into his face. He appeared nearly speechless, his features frozen. The little boy who had once seemed so happy and self-assured had disappeared. He had been replaced by someone else, a different person, now deeply shy, distant, nearly uncommunicative. It was this child who entered Hazel Harvey Elementary School in the fall of 1966. It was not surprising then that a month later, when I met with Jeff's first grade teacher, her description of my son was of this new person. Mrs. Allard, an extremely empathetic teacher, told me that Jeff had impressed her as being inordinately shy and reclusive. He had been polite and had followed all her instructions, but he had given the impression of a profound unhappiness. He had not interacted with the other children. Although he had done the work assigned to him, he had done it without interest, merely as a task that had to be completed. He had not been able to engage in conversation with other children. He had not responded to their casual approaches, nor made any approaches of his own. On the playground, he had kept to himself, merely pacing about the schoolyard, doing what she described as nothing. Of course, to me, all of this was rooted in the fact that we had suddenly moved Jeff to a different house, a different neighborhood, even a different state. I had heard other stories of children who had been briefly disoriented by being abruptly taken from familiar settings and plopped down in completely unfamiliar ones. The somberness I saw in his manner struck me as no more than a normal reaction. My son, it seemed to me, was not very good at adapting to new circumstances, but this was a flaw that could hardly be seen as fatal. Still, Jeff's shyness and reclusiveness were serious enough to require some kind of action. As for the teacher, in concluding our meeting, she assured me that she would do all she could to bring Jeff out a bit, integrate him into the school community. On the way home that evening, I recalled my own early shyness. It seemed to me that Jeff's behavior during the preceding weeks had been more or less the same as mine had been on those occasions when I had suddenly found myself thrust into unfamiliar surroundings. As a boy, I'd been horribly shy, just as he was. Each year, I had dreaded moving up to the next grade, even when that move would not mean any change in school buildings, and despite the fact that I would still be surrounded by children I already knew. It was as if some element of my character yearned for complete predictability, for rigid structure. Change, whether good or bad, was something fearful to me, something to be avoided. Awkward and insecure, plagued by a grave sense of my own inadequacy, as a child I had conceived of the world as something hostile and suspicious, a place that sometimes confused me and which, because of that, I had come to regard with a sense of grave uneasiness. It was as if I could not exactly figure out the social connections that others seemed to understand immediately. The subtleties of social life were beyond my grasp. When children liked me, I did not know why. When they disliked me, I did not know why. Nor could I formulate a plan for winning their affection. I simply didn't know how things worked with other people. There seemed to be a certain randomness and unpredictability in their attitudes and actions. And try as I might, I couldn't find a way to make other people seem less strange and unknowable. Because of that, the social world seemed vague and threatening. And so, as a boy, I had approached it with a great lack of confidence, even dread. As I later observed Jeff, noting his fear of school, his awkwardness and lack of friends, it struck me that he had probably inherited this same dread. Because I had experienced it before him, I sympathized with it and felt that I understood it. In the same sense, because I had become familiar with this dread, it had become less dreadful, and over the years I had been able to create a life that seemed to function more or less like any other. I had managed to get an education. I had a family and held down a job. Despite the dread, the feelings of inferiority, the terrible shyness, all the insecurities that had afflicted me as a boy and which still lingered into adulthood, despite all of those things, I was living what I and others took to be a normal life. And so when I saw these same characteristics as they emerged in Jeff, they did not appear to me as anything particularly dangerous or frightening. I had been plagued by the same feelings that were plaguing him, but I had learned to cope with them and finally to overcome them. Since, over the years, I had learned to live with them, I saw no reason why my son could not learn to live with them too. I realize now that I was wrong, that Jeff's boyhood condition was far graver than mine had ever been. For while I had suffered from shyness, Jeff had begun to suffer from a near total isolation. While I had known the power of an odd fascination, Jeff had begun to move into the grip of a profound perversity. Now, when I gaze at the photographs of him from that time, I wonder at all that must have been forming behind his eyes. I also wonder if there were any visible signs of it. Could I have glimpsed it had I been more watchful? Would I have recognized what it was I glimpsed, or would I have quickly filed it under the generic label of childhood trouble and let it go, hoping that adulthood would bring a cure for whatever it was I sensed but could not clearly understand? Was there any means by which I might have pulled my son from the jaws that were beginning to devour him? When I ask myself these questions, a memory invariably returns to me. Not long after we left Pamel Court, as I drove down the street coming home from work, I saw Jeff alone at the edge of the lawn. It had been raining, and he was dressed in a winter jacket and stocking cap. As I neared him, I could see that he was flailing about, his arms in the air, his dog Frisky barking loudly as she circled him wildly. For a moment they seemed to be playing together, but as I pulled into the driveway, I could see that Jeff had become mired in mud at the edge of the lawn and was trying desperately to extricate himself. He was sobbing loudly, huge tears cascading down his face, and I could see that his fear of being pulled down or swallowed up by the earth had sent him into a full-scale panic. I ran to him as fast as I could, snatched him from the mud, and lifted him into my arms. I could see his face light up with a great joy and sense of rescue. He was smiling and crying at the same time. his whole being flooded with the immense relief that someone, at last, had seen his distress and had finally pulled him from the sucking earth. He leaned toward me, his arms wrapped tightly around my neck, and brought his face very close to mine. I can still remember the sweetness of his breath, the immense gratitude I could see in his eyes. I know now what my son must have felt at that moment. His father had rescued him from what had seemed a terrible fate, and perhaps in his young mind, Jeff might have believed that I would always be able to see his peril and snatch him from it. But the part of Jeff that was most in danger was invisible to me. I could see only those aspects of his character that he chose to show, which resembled some of my own characteristics, the shyness, the general tone of acceptance, the tendency to withdraw from conflict. I suppose, like most fathers, I even took some comfort, perhaps even a bit of pride, in thinking that my son was a bit like me. We moved again when Jeff was 7, this time to a rented house in Barberton. I assumed that he would deal with it in his own way. It would disorient him again, but it seemed to me that learning to deal with change was a lesson in itself. Change, after all, was a part of life, something no one could avoid. In being moved yet again, Jeff was only being taught another lesson in learning to adapt. By then, of course, Jeff was already having to adapt to more than a new location. Several months before, Joyce had given birth to our second son, David. Unlike Jeff, David had had a difficult first few months. He had suffered from colic and kept Joyce and me up night after night. This increased the tension that had been steadily building between the two of us, and everything became considerably more difficult. This problem was made worse by the fact that Joyce had gone into an acute depression. She was extremely irritable and spent much of her time in bed. With Joyce in such a condition, most of the household and child-rearing duties fell to me. Because of this, I attended worship services with Jeff less and less frequently until I finally rationalized that I could be spiritually fulfilled by reading at home. Some of these duties, however, were quite pleasant, and I particularly remember the 2-mile walks I took with Jeff and his dog Frisky to a farm to buy eggs, returning to cook breakfast for all of us. Then on Saturday afternoons, Jeff and I drove to nearby Barberton, Ohio, for our regular chocolate ice cream sodas, a habit carried over from Ames, Iowa. My relationship with Joyce was less pleasant, however. Although we argued quite a bit, our arguments remained within what might be called the normal limits. We did not scream at each other. We did not throw things. We fought, then retired from the field. But there were also good times interspersed among the bad, so it was hard for me to tell that our marriage was beginning to unravel. Dave was 5 months old when we moved to Barberton. It was in April of 1967, and Dave slept in Joyce's arms as we drove to our new house. As for Jeff, he sat in the back seat, rather blank, neither excited nor particularly frightened, as if his emotional range had begun to narrow. The intensity of his earlier feelings had leveled off. He seemed more passive, his attitude taking on the strange resignation that would soon become a central feature of his character. Once in Barberton, I remember Jeff and Frisky playing in the backyard of the new house, Jeff dressed in blue jeans and a striped T-shirt. In flashes, he appeared to return to the carefree and energetic behavior I remembered from Pamel Court. Not long after moving into our new house, he made acquaintance with a young boy who lived in the house behind us. His name was Lee, and he and Jeff played together in the afternoon. In October, they went trick-or-treating together. Joyce served them a witch's brew of orange sherbet and ginger ale, and then the two set out together, marching from house to house throughout the neighborhood, both of them dressed as devils. Before leaving, the two boys stood together for a photograph, both of them smiling brightly in their devil costumes. In the picture, Jeff is on the left, and there is no suggestion that within a few years his life would veer radically away from the life of that other little boy. He seems relaxed, happy, totally at ease with his newfound friend. I have looked at this picture many times, and there is not the slightest hint that in only a few years my son would find it so difficult to confront another human being that he would lie in wait for a jogger he had found attractive, lie in wait in the bushes with a baseball bat in his hand, with the intent of using it to knock out the jogger so that he could lie down with him, as he later said, lie down with an unconscious body. In the photograph, there is not a hint that he was becoming so afraid of other people, so intimidated by their presence, that in order for him to have contact with them, they needed to be dead. Even now, when I think of all that has happened since that time, I wonder if it might have been possible to stop his course. Clearly, there were flashes of affection when something kind and childlike burst through the enveloping mask of distance and withdrawal. There was even at least one instance when Jeff was in the third grade when he actually reached out to someone beyond the family circle. She was an assistant teacher, and I don't know the exact nature of their relationship, only that Jeff developed a certain fondness for her. Perhaps she had befriended him in some small way. Perhaps she had tried to break through an isolation and sense of trouble that she could see better than either Joyce or I could. Perhaps it was no more than a smile or a touch that she had casually extended, which had struck Jeff as something wonderful and delicious. Years later, when I asked Jeff why he had come to like this particular woman, he responded with little more than a verbal shrug. "She was nice to me, I guess," he answered in the lifeless monotone that had become his voice by then. He did not remember her name, nor anything she had done that had caused him to like her more than any other teacher. It was as if she had been no more than a passing shadow, mildly pleasant, but of no importance. And so I will never know what it was in this woman that made Jeff respond to her. I only know that he did respond, did reach out, did make a small, awkward gesture toward another human being. It was nothing more than a child's gift, a bowl of tadpoles which Jeff had caught in a stream in the field behind UL Light School, where Jeff, Frisky, and I regularly roamed and shot basketballs on Saturdays and sometimes after work. He gave them to her innocently as an expression of his affection. Later, however, he found out that the teaching assistant had given these same tadpoles to Lee. In revenge, Jeff later sneaked into Lee's garage, found the bowl of tadpoles, and poured motor oil into their water, killing them. To my knowledge, this was Jeff's first act of violence. One of the guide wires that had held him in check suddenly slipped from its securing bolt, and for a fleeting moment, the darker Jeff, the one who was growing larger and larger as my son grew up, suddenly emerged in the form of a little boy pouring motor oil into a bowl of tadpoles. In the years to come, that darker side would grow more powerful in my son until it finally attached itself to his budding sexuality, and after that, entirely consumed him. Chapter 3. I remember my first sexual fantasy. I was probably around 10 years old at the time, and I had taken to reading Little Abner in the comics. In reading it, I had become fixated on the robust and buxom women who appeared in the strip. In my fantasy, I dreamed of being taken by one of them in some kind of sexual embrace. It wasn't sex exactly, but I know that it was rooted in sex, and that comic book characters, rather than real people, were the first genuine objects of my emerging sexual desire. In later years, all of that would change, and my fantasies would begin to move toward more predictable objects of desire, women of great beauty whom I saw in magazines, or famous singers and movie stars. My fantasy life would become, for lack of a better word, normal, and I would dream of the blonde girl who lived down the street, my sexuality gradually taking on those richer and more mature aspects that finally allowed it to be linked to love. Sometimes when I think of Jeff at 9 or 10, I wonder if he had begun to move toward some fantasy that came from nowhere and slowly began to take up permanent residence in his mind. In a psychiatric evaluation which I later read, my son claimed to have had his first sexual fantasies at around 14. but I saw changes in Jeff long before he reached that age, and it is hard for me to believe that dark notions, regardless of how vague and formless, were not already shaping in his mind. For one thing, his posture and the general way in which he carried himself changed radically during the years between his 10th and 15th years. The loose-limbed boy disappeared and was replaced by a strangely rigid and inflexible figure. He looked continually tense, his body very straight. When he walked, his legs appeared to lock at the knee. This caused his legs to stiffen so much that his feet seemed to scrape across the ground, as if he were dragging them along rather than being carried by them. He grew increasingly shy during this time as well, and when approached by other people, he would become very tense. Often he would grab a small stick or a piece of grass and begin winding it nervously around his fingers. It was as if he could not confront another person without holding on to something, a mooring, perhaps, or a weapon. More and more he remained at home, alone in his room or staring at television. His face was often blank, and he gave the more or less permanent impression of someone who could do nothing but mope around, purposeless and disengaged. Many times I tried to pull him from what I saw as the quagmire of his own inactivity, only to discover that his interest remained limited and desultory, that he did not stick with things for very long. At various times he tried both soccer and tennis, but eventually gave them up. We lived in a large wooded area at this time, and so after tennis and soccer had failed to engage Jeff, I decided that he might prefer a more solitary pastime. I bought him a professional-level bow and arrow, set up a target in one of the broad open fields, and taught him how to shoot. Initially, he appeared quite interested in the sport, and we would often go target shooting together. But once again, in what had become a predictable pattern, he quickly lost interest, and the bow and arrow were tucked into the back corner of his closet while Jeff lay sprawled on his bed or walked aimlessly about the house. By the time he was 12, Jeff had given up most of what young boys continued to pursue during their pre-adolescence. He cared very little for sports, even less for boyhood academic pursuits like chemistry or biology sets. Although a Boy Scout trip to New Mexico appeared to have intrigued him, he made no effort to stay in the Scouts once he returned home. By the time he reached 15, he had abandoned almost everything to which I had introduced him. He appeared shy, as always, but even less self-confident. During this time, I found that to some extent I could identify with Jeff's situation. I could recognize certain features of my own boyhood and what I saw him going through. I had sometimes felt left out, particularly when some of my friends began to go out on dates. Like Jeff, I appeared quite introverted. But unlike me, Jeff seemed unable to pursue even the most casual interests. He never read anything other than the books assigned in school, and science fiction, and Alfred Hitchcock's book called Horror Stories for Children. Although he participated in the school band for a time, he showed no interest in music, no interest in art. Even worse, he showed no interest in other people. And even though he considered a neighborhood boy, Greg, as his closest friend until they drifted apart at age 15, he never developed relationships with his fellow schoolmates. Because of all this, it was easy for me to see my own pre-adolescence as very similar to Jeff's, and it struck me that at some point in my boyhood I had hit upon something that had helped me to come out of my shyness by building up my self-confidence. It was possible, I thought at the time, that the strategy might work for Jeff as well. I suggested bodybuilding. I thought if he could get a better image of himself physically, then perhaps he might become less isolated socially. It had worked for me to a great extent, and I hoped that it would work for him. I mentioned bodybuilding to Jeff one afternoon, and he took an immediate interest. A few days later, I came home with a bull worker for isometric exercises and showed him how to use it. As he listened to me give my instructions, he seemed more engaged than I had seen him in a long time. During the next few weeks, I often caught glimpses of Jeff spread out on the floor of his room, intently at work with the bull worker I had bought him. At other times, the door would be closed, but I could hear Jeff breathing loudly behind it as he pumped furiously at his newfound toy. Although the bull worker occupied Jeff for a good year and afforded him a well-developed 16-year-old upper body, it too was set aside, joining the tennis racket, the soccer ball, and the bow and arrow in Jeff's unlighted closet. Now, when I think of these discarded things, they take on a deep metaphorical significance for me. They are the small, ultimately ineffectual offerings I made in the hope of steering my son toward a normal life. When I remember them, I see them almost as artifacts of a blasted life, curiosities united by nothing more than a deep, enduring sadness. For the Jeff who might have been engaged by such things was already gone. And so, during the next few years, instead of pursuing any of the interests and activities which I had naively offered him, my son would find interests of his own. Steadily, and without my knowing it, his fascination with bones would develop into a full-blown adolescent obsession. As I first learned at the trial in February of 1992, he would begin to roam the nearby streets of our neighborhood, always on his bike, but further equipped with a supply of plastic garbage bags with which he could retrieve the remains of animals he found along his way. He would gather together these animal remains and create his own private cemetery. He would strip the flesh from the bodies of these putrescent roadkills and even mount a dog's head on a stake. As I heard about these activities for the first time at the trial, I wondered why someone hadn't mentioned even one of these incidents to me. And even more puzzling, why hadn't I seen evidence of these things? Many months after the trial, I learned that the cemetery had been on a small, mounded area in the woods on a neighbor's property across the road, and that the dog's head on a stake had been in a secluded area of woods southwest of our property, two neighbors away. As a person, Jeff would grow more passive, more solitary, more inexpressibly isolated. He would have neither male nor female friends. He would form no relationships other than the most casual and convenient. In the world outside his mind, everything would become increasingly dull and flat, his conversation narrowing to the practice of answering questions with barely audible one-word responses. The boy who sat across from me at the dinner table, his face now adorned with glasses, his eyes dull, his mouth set in a motionless rigidity, was drifting into a nightmare world of unimaginable fantasies. In the coming years, those fantasies would begin to overwhelm him. He would be assailed by visions of murder and dismemberment. The dead, in their stillness, would become the primary objects of his growing sexual desire. More and more, as a teenager, his inability to speak about such strange and unsettling notions would sever his connections to the world outside himself. But all that I really noticed during those years of my son's adolescence was his increasing inwardness and disconnection. He did only what he had to do in school and exhibited neither interests nor ambitions. While others planned for college or careers, Jeff seemed completely disengaged. He never talked about the future, and I think now that he never believed that he actually had one. In any event, he seemed completely unmotivated, at times almost inert, and I can only imagine that given the unspeakable visions and desires that had begun to overwhelm him at that time, he must have come to view himself as utterly outside the human community, outside all that was normal and acceptable, outside all that could be admitted to another human being. At least to himself, he was already a prisoner, already one of the condemned. But the visible manifestations of Jeff's spiritual and emotional descent were slight, at least when compared to the depth of that descent. There was no screaming in the night, no rambling speech, no moments of catatonic blankness. He didn't hear or see things that weren't there. He never exploded suddenly, never so much as raised his voice in either fear or anger. If he had done any of these things, then I might have sensed how deeply he was moving into his madness. And sensing that, I might not only have saved him somehow, but all the others he destroyed as well. But rather than demonstrating any blatant show of mental illness, Jeff simply became more quiet and enclosed. Our conversations were reduced to question and answer sessions that were really not conversations at all. There was no communication in them, no debate, no sense of information given or received. He never argued, but neither did he ever seem fully to agree with anything. It was as if nothing mattered to him, neither schoolwork nor social relations in or out of school. And yet even this did not manifest itself as a form of rebellion. Rebellion would have demanded some measure of belief, some expression of his personal convictions. But Jeff was beyond rebellion, and he had no convictions about anything. There were times when I would glimpse him alone in his room or sitting in front of the television, and it would seem to me that he could not think at all. I know now what he was thinking of at those times when a blank stare rose into his eyes. And I also know that all those things that were foremost in my son's mind during those years were, in essence, incommunicable, either to me or to anyone else. Even if Jeff had had a friend, he could not have revealed the bizarre and violent impulses that had begun to occupy his mind. How could a teenage boy admit, perhaps even to himself, that the landscape of his developing inner life had become a slaughterhouse, a morgue? And so my son went elsewhere with his confusion and distress. He went where millions of others had gone before him, seeking solace or forgetfulness, as he must have been seeking it. He went to the bottle. By the time he finished high school, he was a full-fledged alcoholic. This, however, was completely unknown to me. Preoccupied by the continuing dissolution of my marriage, as well as my duties at work, I remained entirely oblivious to Jeff's drinking. I know now that he took liquor from a neighbor's house, drinking in secret much of the time. I know that he concealed his drinking from me as any boy would. Moreover, I was often preoccupied with Dave, my other son, and Jeff increasingly slipped by me unawares, a figure who was diminishing before me as a person, even as his body grew. But as the years passed, it was not only alcoholism into which Jeff sank. By the time he was 15, his mind had begun to dissolve completely into a nightmare world. Once that world had taken over completely, it began to dictate every facet of my son's inner life by attaching itself to his developing sexuality, the most powerful force a teenage boy may know. Bizarre notions of death and dismemberment became sexually charged, sexually driven, sexually satisfied. I can only guess at the inner world into which that process must have hurled my son. I know that as he grew deeper into his adolescence, his face took on an even greater sense of something concealed. In photographs taken near the end of his high school years, his eyes appear more narrow, his gaze more distant, his smile entirely false. During that time, his level of effort sank to the minimum, and at home he became more withdrawn. His social life, which should have been expanding, narrowed to a circle that was no larger than his mind, an imagined world in which his friends were phantoms, his lovers mere lumps of unmoving flesh.
Dark flesh. Negro male flesh. Katherine Massey Book Club, Context of White Supremacy. Well, first session, and this is not a long book. We are basically a little less than a third of the way through, so it should really only be three sessions. Hit it and quit it, out of here. Number to dial, 605-313-5164. The code, 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164. Decode 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. The email, untiljustice@gmail.com. If you did not share at all first time around, make sure you do not wait until the last minute. Go ahead, *61, and we'll make sure that you get to the front of the caller line to share. Let's see, make sure we get in our folks who emailed as well. Email number two. Hi, Gus, Cal's audience, callers. Once again, great follow-up to Mother Superior, Sue Klebold's book, A Mother's Reckoning. I'm reading the foreword to the new book, and I'm not surprised that it was republished due to the sustained interest and willingness of fans to pay over the odds for a copy of this book. I do work with Jeffrey Dahmer's greatest fangirl. Oh, that's right. That's right. I forgot all about that. One thing that has struck me already is that Marshall Glickman, who is the publisher and person who wrote the foreword, refers to Lionel Dahmer's book as one aspect of a multi-layered and extreme tragedy. I noticed the same pattern in Sue Klebold's book, but was too exhausted to include my comments in my summing up of that book. But it really bothered me, just like the discussion during the last book on how white people use the word normal. I'm questioning the use of the word tragedy. It's inappropriate and, in my opinion, used to minimize the barbaric and depraved nature of white crimes. From here on, I will pay attention to how the word gets used by white people. I'm aware of the case and will re-listen to the previous Cal's broadcasts as my memory has faded. I suspect, like with the Columbine case, I will gain lots of insight on the true nature of Jeffrey Dahmer, his parents, childhood, and crimes he committed. It will be interesting to see what, if any, responsibility the parents take for what he turned into, if there are any similar patterns of ignoring problems with his behavior, although I believe there was a history of parental neglect. Other patterns to pay attention to, in addition to the racism: police cover-ups, white people's fascination and admiration of this murderer, commercialization. I said Fox Nation 3 days ago released the four-part documentary. Four, media glorification. 3 days ago, Fox Nation. Number five, child abuse. Number six, devaluing black life. They only got a portion of the proceeds from the book. Not like old Sue Klebold. Let's see. Folks who dialed in, email again, untiljustice@gmail.com. Folks who dialed in, if you have commentary to share, let's see. Our caller 2456 missed you first time around. Did you have commentary?
Got a little commentary. Hey, Cows. I just started listening, and so I'm creeped out. The narrator used the word delicious. I was creeped out. They got the dark. They want to say everything is dark. And for the dad, if I'm hearing it right, he's going with, well, I didn't really know he was like that. You know, he was picking up dead animals and bringing them home and making his own cemetery, but I didn't really know anything was wrong with them. And so these people, they love it. They love killing, and like he said, he's jumping out of the bushes with a baseball bat to knock somebody out, not to rob them or nothing. That's not better, but not to rob them, to sit there and have sex with them? No. And he wrote this book just trying to get some more money. This is the father of Jeffrey Dahmer, so it's just, I'm going to stay listening. I might not say a lot, but no. Absolutely not. Horrible. Horrible people.
All righty. No fan of Lionel Dahmer and old Joyce so far. Much obliged for your commentary. Old Lionel said, I didn't know, man. I knew there was something wrong, but who could have imagined? Let's see. Other folks who dialed in with commentary, if you have a hand up, proceed.
Worst people on the planet. Somebody needs to do something about this.
folks, I guess, are getting their notes and such together, I'll make sure I get in the rest of our email. First email I read our second email. Going back to finish up all of email number one. I left off at number three. Number four. Read number four. Number five, surgery. Pain. Asked if the doctors cut off his penis. This struck me as an odd statement by a child. He was having all the pain. They had surgery in the nether region. So, I don't know, maybe the pain was so excruciating. His child brain computer, that seemed like it could have been logical to explain all the pain he was in, maybe. I don't know. Number six, more withdrawn, inward. Would white parents today have sought out professional psychological help? I don't know. I would think if Mom Joyce is taking, he said, 26 pills a day before, I don't know. I think they would have had some sort of mental health intervention. He would have been Adderall something. You got a PhD and you're a scientist. That means you got some sort of health plan, more than likely. I think, yeah, probably today he would have at least been on some. I mean, Eric was on medication, so I mean, yeah, they would have had him on something, I suspect. I don't know if that would have. Now, I mean, Eric was on medication and they still had the bombing. So, you know, that's not to say that it would have stopped all of this. But, yeah, he probably would have got some. He could have been on 26 pills a day, too. Let's see. Other folks who get my notes, if folks are still pondering or if they have their thoughts from the second portion of the reading. Let's see.
I'm ready. Can I be heard?
Lauren, yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Thank you for allowing me to speak again. At the beginning of this session, he said, I received my PhD. Hold on. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so he said, I received my PhD in October of 1966, and a month later, I took my first job as a research chemist for a large chemical company in the Akron, Ohio area. We found a small house in Doylestown, a colonial twinplex with four white columns on the front, the largest house we'd ever lived in. So that sounds pretty nice. Then talks about Joyce, and it says she's taking 2 to 3 Equinil a day to help with her condition, but they did not seem to help very much, so the dosage was increased to 3 to 5 tablets a day. Even this increase did not ameliorate her general condition. Wow, that seems like a lot of drugs for a pregnant lady. Let me see. Then he talks about the way Jeffrey is changing as a child and when he goes to school. He says, during this time, of course, I spent most of my time at work at my new job. In the lab, I once again found a wonderful comfort and assurance in knowing the properties of things, how they could be manipulated in predictable patterns. It proved a great relief from the chaos I found at home, the volatility of Joyce's emotions, the continual shifts within her mood. The lab was a haven from those storms, and I probably worked even longer hours because of that. So I thought that was interesting. He talked about that before, right, that he likes to be at work. He doesn't like to deal with people. He likes to, you know, deal with his chemicals because he knows what's going to happen. He can predict it. And it seems like Jeffrey got some of that from his father. Also, it says it was if he – he's talking about Jeff at school. I skipped that part. Sorry. It was as if he had come to expect that other people might harm him in some way, and so he wanted to stay clear of them. I think that's fascinating. I think this is a very common with white people. They're causing harm to all of the other people on the planet, so they have this conscious and or subconscious fear that other people are going to start harming them. And the stiffness, it's like, well, Jeffrey has the stiffness, and I also think Joyce, her limbs stiffened during her pregnancy. So I'm like wondering if there's some sort of relation between the way they react to feeling distressed. Let me see. My son, it seemed to me, was not very good at adapting to new circumstances, but this was a flaw that could hardly be seen as fatal. Oof. Fatal, not fatal to whom? That was a weird thing to say, and it's interesting that it got all the way through the editing. I noticed some of the language he was talking, like he said the part of Jeff that was most in danger was invisible to me. He used similar language when he was talking about the relationship he had with his father when he was a younger child. They moved a lot. Like, I've lost track of how many times they moved, and, you know, Jeffrey's still pretty young. It seems like that would cause a lot of upheaval in a child. I mean, it causes that in me, and I'm in my 40s. So, you know, it's really hard for me to imagine how that would affect a child. I also noted the October part, the Halloween part. Someone else already commented on it, but they go trick-or-treating. Joy serves them a witch's brew. They take this photograph, both of them smiling brightly together in devil costumes. And he says, in the picture, Jeff is on the left, and there is no suggestion that within a few years, his life would veer radically away from the life of that other little boy. He seems relaxed, happy, and totally at ease with his newfound friend. I have looked at that picture many times, and there's not the slightest hint that in only a few years, my son would find it so difficult to confront another human being that he would lie in wait for a jogger he'd found attractive. Lie in wait in the bushes with a baseball bat in his hand with the intent of using it to knock out the jogger so that he could lie down with him, as he later said, lie down with an unconscious body. In the photograph, there's not a hint that he was becoming so afraid of other people, so intimidated by their presence, that in order for him to have contact with them, they needed to be dead. Wow. That was just, I think this text so far is fascinating. I think he is revealing a lot about his mental state. I was going to say emotional state, but he actually does not seem emotional at all. So mental state, I think, is a more accurate term. Oh, the tadpoles part was interesting, too. And that's all I have right now.
Killed him with the black oil, the tadpoles, after his friend stole the gift. Talk about the overlap, see? My man Reb, he told us, put that in the basement tapes, didn't he? He said, hey, man. Part of this is parents' fault. Moved us around all the time. Always got to be starting at the bottom of the food chain. Picked on. Every time you get a little bit of seniority, got to lift up our tent, pack up our tent. Move to another. They were in Wisconsin. Pack up our tent. Move to another town. Go someplace else. Start all over again. I'm going to blow up the school. It's hard. Even for older folks, it can be hard moving. They said they have a chart on stressful life events. Moving is very high on that list, and that's for, like, grown white people. So for a child, that can be, you know, losing your friends and all of everything Eric and them talked about. So, yes. Now, most people do not become cannibals or mass killers because they have to move as a child, but still. Much obliged, Lauren. Let's see, *61. Other folks, they have commentary. Check the email. I'll even see if I can get in a few of my own notes before we wrap up. In fact, sundown towns should be racially restricted regions. We have heard bunches of them. I told you West Allis already. Doylestown, Ohio. I'm just going to go. James Lowen reread Sundown Towns in my top 10 reluctantly now for this very reason. So the Chippewa Township in Ohio. I'm just reading directly from the website. There have been, oh, wait a minute. It's got, oh, the census information. They say it's probable that this was a sundown town. There have also been some interesting leads in Doylestown with African Americans, strike workers brought from Virginia and kept in a stockade. They were dis- disappeared from Doylestown after the 1900 census. Many moved to the next town over, while others returned home to Virginia. None stayed in Doylestown. It may have just been that they were not welcomed because of the strike situation, or, as the woman from the Historical Society suggested, there was no industry here and there were no jobs besides the mines. This is from 2008. Doylestown is a small village within Chippewa Township. The manuscript census figures for Chippewa Township and the Silver Creek Mine, where the strike was, also in the township. The first record of a black family living in the township was a barber named Lewis Holmes and his wife Flora in 1870. In 1880, Chippewa, during the nadir of race relations, common phrase, we've heard it before in the book club, 122 black and biracial men suddenly appeared in the town census. By the 1900 census, the township was once again 100% black, white. In Chippewa in the 1880, there was a coal miner strike where the miners wanted more money from the employer Erastus Loomis, so Loomis decided to bring black strike breakers from Virginia to his Silver Creek mines in Chippewa and Wadsworth. A local map from the 1950s shows it as the Nigger Mine, in quotes. Loomis hired carpenters to make a stockade to keep the blacks safe. The white miners were upset, and they talked about driving the blacks out of the mine. 500 men stoned the barricade around the mines and injured one of the constables. 80 soldiers were stationed at the mine for 6 weeks to protect the miners. There is no record of any further violence occurred. Local historians say they simply eventually drifted back to the south, and a few moved away to nearby Wadsworth. And it concludes there, but even this town, and there, I told you Amos and many of the other ones, but it's rare to find a town where they say it is 100% black. Like, we don't have a Negro butler, nanny, nothing. Like, zero Negros here at all. Doylestown. Let's see. All of these strange fears. Dr. Welsing, she talked about this case with us as well, right after we spoke with Dr. Dvorak a decade ago. But she talks in the ISIS papers, and she talked continually about white people's disconnection. That's in Yorugu, Dr. Marimba Ani as well. White people's disconnection from humanity, nature, the creator, all of that. And that's both of these books, or both, we just read about Columbine, but that's both of these, where the alienation. Even with Dill, Eric saying the same thing, I'm disconnected and I don't have any friends and all that, keep having to move, whatever the reason is, having those physical deformities. Dr. Langman wrote about that. We heard that both ways too. But even Dill, in the last session in Sue's book, they go to that restaurant and he is making up, oh my gosh, we got to leave. They're going to beat me up. They're out to get me. Look at them. They're coming. We got to. What is all of that? Dr. Welsing connects that directly to white genetic annihilation and all of that paranoia and hysteria. They're going to get us. They're out to get us. They're going to steal our water. What are we going to do? We got to get guns. We got to get a book. Like, what are you talking about? What is wrong with you? Dr. Welsing talked about that, all of that alienation and what have you, and all of that lying and puffing yourself up as supreme when you really have all of these feelings of inadequacy and insecurity. That's why you got to be taking all these drugs and what have you. She talked about all of that extensively in the ISIS papers. She says, let's see, just going to school and being frightened and like, are you serious? You're not even a Negro. In fact, I'm putting this in context. He's born in 1960. That's right in the smack dab middle of the civil rights movement. Could that be a part of the unnerving that's happening with these white people? Wife included, all of this social upheaval bothering white people to some degree. They say it's multi-layered. I mean, 1960, that's right in the middle of all of this, right? And he does end up chomping black people, yes? I was even thinking about that. What type of school was he going? Was it so-called integrated or whatever? Was it Negro students around? Same thing with Dill. Like, he's at a school, hardly any dark people, right? Let's see. Well, because they use the word integrate. Jeff's shyness and reclusiveness were serious enough to require some kind of action. As for the teacher, in concluding our meeting, she assured me that she would do all that she could to bring Jeff out of it. integrate him into the school community. That's why I said, was it this an all-white school at this time? Was it being integrated, so-called? Was that a part of his discomfort? I find that, the fact that the father really has not mentioned racism at all. His racial classification, talked about this with our guest, Mark Neil Klaus, this week. Dexter doesn't get classified as white, and so far in this text, neither does Jeff and his family. And during this time period, are you serious? 1964, that's right, when Dr. King wins Nobel Peace Prize and all the rest of it. Like, dang, no mention of any of that during this time period? What's our stand? I mean, really, given what happens in this book, you don't even have a sentence? I just want to make it clear, me and Joyce, we were all about Dr. King. We supported it. I mean, let me tell you about some integration. We supported integration. We marched with Dr. King, I'm going to tell you. We even sent money. Got a photocopy here. We sent a check to the NAACP. None of that. None of that. That strikes me, even I would even put that up as kind of Sue Klebold dishonest, really, given what happens with all of this. Like, man, this can't be no mention of race. No mention that we're white. Let's see. Inferiority, even the words, terrible shyness. Like, I know niggers in remedial classes who don't sound this, but like, get it together, man. Isaiah Scholes, get it together, man. Kyle Velasquez, get it, you got a dad with a PhD. Come on, the same thing for old Dill. Like, what are you, get it together, man. Let's see. Barberton, I didn't get a chance to check. I bet that's probably some downtown too. But they drove to Barberton for, what did they drive for? Chocolate ice cream sodas. Dr. Francis Craig, you heard that, Neely Fuller. Chocolate factory. Let's see. Oh, and they clowned with the dogs too. Eric had his dog named Sparky. He put the boom at the school. And then Jeff has his dog named Frisky. He liked to drug and rape you. Say, Jeff is frisky. I can't do it. Let's see. Oh, the whole Halloween. Oh, my gosh. Man, I told you it was a slight nudge. I didn't really want to read this book, but it was a slight nudge. Mama C said, dang, this same day a year ago when that Netflix series came out. We said last year, it's in the archives. Dang, they put this series out for the Equinox? Irie said, and Halloween? That's their favorite holiday. All this bloodletting? They love that. And then they walk right into that, into this book. We get all gussied up for what? Halloween, trick-or-treating. Joyce served the witch's brew. They dressed as devil. Like, come on. Come on. And they smiled brightly as devils. You can't make this up, man. I bet that's in the Netflix series where they got Jeff dressed up as the devil going out to get Snickers bars, Hershey's, Reese cups, chocolate, Tootsie Pops, Lord, chocolate sauce. We were just talking about delectable Negro, Lord. And the teacher, I think the caller said that the teacher was struck Jeff as delicious. I did think that was kind of like the same thing with Sue saying that she felt the town's wrath, like Lionel. Maybe we're going to take that delicious thing out. Especially the edit time was kind of like, maybe that's in bad taste, forgive the pun, but we will say she was attractive, or she caught his eye. We'll think of something catchy, but not delicious. Let's see. The darker, all the, I want to see how many times dark is in this book, man. The darker Jeff, the one growing larger and larger as my son grew up, suddenly emerged from in the form of a little boy pouring motor oil into a bowl of tadpoles in the years to come, the darker side. Like, what? Come on, man. Come on. And my, all of that white supremacy, racism, and to me, it seems like it would have to be willful because they say it so frequently and all over the world when talking about white criminal behavior, often like the most vile white terrorist behavior, cannibals and mass murderers and serial killers. Killing one person is horrible enough, but I mean lots of folks and eating them and all this vile behavior is someone classified as white? Why is that dark behavior? And then he's killing black people on top, like, come on. Let's see. His fantasy life, he's dreaming of a blonde girl. Always so interesting the way that hair and hair color pops up in these books. We have come a long way from reading about Negroes with kinky hair in Brazil. Let's see. Here, the same thing with Dill and Reb, where it seems that these white boys get so much independence to just go in their room and make their bombs or dissect animals, do some kidnapping, whatever they want to do. They got free reign. Nobody comes in my room. You better not go in my room. Like, wow, I don't know. I didn't have that sort of autonomy as a young person. He gets away. Now, he just says, just dad says that he's all awkward and everything, and he needs some sort of crutch, i.e. weapon, to be secure in public. What should we do? I know, we'll get him a bow and arrow. Like, what? What? Why is that the default? Now, we did just hear that yesterday for South Africa. You're a child. We take you out to the camp and train weapons, survival. Yes, the Negroes might do the same. Paranoia and fear. Why is it a bow and arrow? I didn't get a weapon. At 10, 12, you're a little awkward, little Gussie. You need to, you know, firm up your backbone. I know. Get you a Sig Sauer. Get you a BB gun. A rifle. A bow and arrow. A knife. A dagger. Like, what? Come on. Some nunchucks. Come on. Let's see. Man, we heard with Sue, she ran the gamut. Arsenic and Lace, Seven Samurai, Magnificent Samurai, whatever the title was. She gave us all the films about killing and murder and all that. Remember that? That they watched happily, talking about their happy family, even leading up to the bombing. He said, old Jeff, he, other than the school books assigned, and science fiction, I know that piqued Lawrence, and like, hey, me and Jeff, same reading. Alfred Hitchcock's book called Horror Stories for Children. I didn't even know such literature exists. I'm going to have to check the library to see what that even entails. Horror Stories for Children. White culture, man. White, and I think, wasn't Sue and them reading out, watching Alfred Hitchcock? I think they were. Oh, let me see. What else? Inwardness disconnected. That's such a, I'm going to have to go back to Dr. Welsing, ISIS papers for that, because she writes about that. So, and that's such a recurring theme for individuals classified as white. Heard that with Dill. Heard that with Eric. You heard that with Ted Kaczynski. It just goes on and on and on and on and on. For what reason? You all dominate. Why would that be? Let's see. Oh, and the alcohol, man. It's so much overlap between these two. It's so much overlap. Underage white drinking. Now I know there are non-white people who do deviant things and drink and all that. It was not that easy for me to access alcohol when I was a young person. Not until I got to college. Then it became much easier. If you have a college ID, you can do some things. But as like a high, like 14? Are you serious? Come on, man. To hear that in all of these books for all of these different white 14, 15, vodka. I got a reputation. I mean, to even hear that now in the murder trial, I keep bringing that up down in South Carolina. But you got whites at 14, 15 and all of that where they got a reputation for alcohol consumption at 14, 15 years old. Like, what in the world? So, and that is in the book on damage to your brain computer. Brain is still developing. You do not want to be consuming narcotics or alcohol. But man, that seems like a really well ingrained part of white culture. Might even be related to some of these shenanigans. Let's see, is that, I think I can leave there. Oh, and we got more of the mind stuff too. He says, by the time he was 15, his mind began to dissolve completely into a nightmare world. Once that world had taken over completely, it began to dictate every facet of my son's inner life by attaching itself to his developing sexuality. the most powerful force a teenage boy may know. I have to think about that for a little bit. Mr. Fuller says the most powerful motivating force in the universe is white supremacy, racism, and Dahmer was munching on mostly dark people. But I have to think about that a little bit. And that's even a teaspoon of that Sue Klebold talking about this is a brain problem with old Jeff Dahmer. He's got a teaspoon of some brain damage of some sort or chemical imbalance in the brain. That's the type of thing that she was talking about a lot in her book. I don't know. I have to think about that as we proceed. A lot of this seems like just typical aspects of white culture, but keep all that in mind as we continuing on. We're picking up next week, chapter 4. Oh, man, he's got a picture of old Jeff, and I guess he's like 7 years old. He's got a picture of Jeff and Frisky. Anyway, much obliged, folks tuning in first time around. This is a short book. We probably will only have 3 sessions left max, so we are a quarter of the way done with A Father's Story. Let us know. We'll get in a few of the audio segments from the Fox Nation documentary as we proceed. Except for what I just said, sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy, especially for the children. Man, if you are going to have offspring under these conditions, they got fentanyl and all the rest of it. Modeling, emphasizing sobriety would be best, and explaining the why all of this is connected to white supremacy, racism. They want your brain on drugs. In fact, even better, if we can get some fentanyl in you so we can get your black behind out of here. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cal signing out. No name calling, no gossiping, no throwaway offspring. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, no brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.